Welcome back for some CIS 2014 Women's Hockey Championship live here from the Grant Harvey Center in Fredericton, New Brunswick. Tonight's game, we got the host St. Thomas University Tommies up against the Montreal Carabins. Nick, tee us up for this one.
Well, Rob, it's pretty simple, really. For the Montreal Carabins, win and you're in. A big win, 3-0 win in their first match on Thursday over Saskatchewan. Put them in a great place to kind of ease their way into the gold medal game on tomorrow night. But for the Carabins, they're up against a tough, feisty St. Thomas Tommies hockey team who came off a great effort last night. Unfortunately, a 3-2 loss at the hands of the Saskatchewan Huskies. But head coach Pete Murphy after the game said that he was ecstatic with the way that his team played, and he was so proud of the effort they put in. Now, for the Tommies, I talked to Coach Murphy before the game, and he said that they're going into this game with the mentality that, hey, we don't have a chance, so why even play? Now, the reason for that, actually, is because he said himself that after last night's game, he heard a lot of people, a lot of the coaches, actually, around saying that, oh, well, Saskatchewan had a bad game, you know, and they didn't play all that well. Well, he's saying, well, what about us? You know, we played a pretty darn good game, too. So they're going in with the mentality that, hey, nobody's giving us a chance. Why don't we just go out and prove them wrong? So that's what they're thinking of. They're going into the mentality again. Coach Murphy saying that, hey, we don't have a chance. Why even play the game at all? With the purpose to proving people wrong. Meanwhile, on the Montreal side of the bench, head coach Isabelle Leclerc, after their 3-0 win against Saskatchewan, said that she really wasn't happy with the way they played, surprisingly. She said that she thought her team could have put up a much better effort in the 3-0 shutout victory, and she wasn't happy with the way that... For Coach Leclerc, too, she said that it wasn't big things, but it was little things. But nonetheless, she said that her team has to be a lot better than that at the national championship. But a 3-0 win, hard to really see how much better you could be. But she said it's just little technical things, you know, handling the puck in their own end and little things like that. But when you're the defending national champions, you want to have your game perfect.
A lot of people around the rink, around the city, including us, were saying St. Thomas's game against Saskatchewan might be the best game so far in this tournament.
Oh, by far, and all four games of this tournament so far, pardon me, all three games of this tournament so far, sorry, I forgot, this is the sixth game.
Yeah.
The first three games of the tournament leading up to last night's game were blowouts.
Yeah.
It was unfathomable. Granted, a 3-0 win isn't necessarily a blowout, but the way that Montreal dominated the Saskatchewan Huskies on day one of this tournament was essentially a blowout.
Yes.
Granted, like Isabelle Leclerc said, her team didn't play all of what she wanted to be. As you hear the Grant Harvey Center now getting electric.
Just
5
roaring.
Minutes to go before this drop of the puck between the St. Thomas Tommies and the Montreal Carabins, but I mean, for this game here, going back to last night's game, like you were saying, Rob, it wasn't for a lot of people the best game that they had seen all year from the Tommies. And, I mean, you bring 1,522 fans into this barn,
yes,
and on top of that, you bring a train horn from the University of Saskatchewan fans. It got pretty loud in this building, and the atmosphere was electric. Same thing again tonight. You have a loud and rowdy Montreal Carabins side of the ice. They have that nice little air horn that you might hear throughout the night going on that left side of the ice. So both teams are very loud, but sorry, I'm trying to get back to my point earlier about how St. Thomas played the best game of the tournament so far. That was the closest game so far of the tournament, making it the best game because, again, we have seen so many blowouts. But the fact that St. Thomas battled back after going down a goal, Emily Ryan coming in 28 seconds later and sniping a shot top shelf and bar down on Cassidy Hendricks of the Saskatchewan Huskies, and then the way St. Thomas fought back in the dying minutes. Of course, they gave up two quick goals back-to-back in that third period, which ultimately was their demise. But for head coach Pete Murphy, getting that goal on the power play with the empty net late in the game was a huge boost for his team, and actually it did a lot more than what you think he does, because that goal there has a huge impact on the goal differential, which later on in the broadcast we'll run down the different scenarios for the St. Thomas Tommies. I know that a couple of our organizing committee staff don't necessarily want to go out yet, just in case, you know, a couple of scenarios can happen. But we'll run those down for you just before the start of the game.
Of course, of course. And what I wanted to get to is how does St. Thomas continue the momentum that they had last night? The great game, maybe their best game of the season. And how can they continue this tonight here against Montreal?
Well, you feed off the crowd first and foremost. Kelty Apperson, after last night's game, said that having the crowd and having those type of fans being loud and proud for them on their side of the ice was a huge motivation. And here come the St. Thomas Tommies out of the dressing room right now.
And you're hearing a loud ovation as Tommy, the Tomcat mascot, is really doing his job down there. He's getting this crowd going, folks. And the Tommies are playing another late game. They get the 7 o'clock start. I just wanted to read a tweet here. And it was from Eliza Snyder. She tweeted this last night after the game. So that's what it feels like to play in front of 1,500 people. Wow.
Hashtag chills. Chills. Oh, jeez. And now here come the Montreal Carabins out on the ice now. And you can hear the air horn on that Montreal side. I know in the press box over there, it's really resonating. And it's echoing. They didn't really find it the best of things in the first game there. But Montreal are out there ready to play too. But St. Thomas, like I said before, for them to continue that effort last night, they need to feed off this crowd and stick to their guns of what got them that close, exciting game last night. Now, we don't know. Maybe Saskatchewan did play a bad game by their standards. We don't know. Certainly not. Steve Cook, the head coach of the Saskatchewan Huskies, certainly didn't think that they played a bad game. So full credit to Pete Murphy and his staff for a good execution of the game plan. But for St. Thomas, they're going to have to rely on that top line of Katie Brewster, Kelty Apperson, and Tia Anderson. Yeah. Right.
So we're
Katie Brewster, we saw a great game from her yesterday.
Oh, of course.
She was all over the ice, trying to create scoring chances no matter how she could. But the big thing for St. Thomas, again, on top of that top line, they're going to need some support to get down in depth because Montreal have a very, very deep team, and they can score off all four of their lines. So top line has got to be productive for St. Thomas, but the second, third, and fourth line especially have to be shut down defense. Or have to have shutdown defense against this Montreal team. Now, the thing with Montreal, too, is we saw this in the first game against Saskatchewan. Their offense is predictable. They ran the exact same offense over and over and over again. They'll take the puck in deep to the corner, look for the pass across the slot, maybe backdoor, yep. And if it's not there, they'll go right back up to the point, and we'll see if they can get that offense going right after O-Canada.
Dennis Livingstone going out to play. Hopefully his mic works tonight. And folks, there you have it. We're about set to go. The Tommies wearing their white unis tonight after playing in their blacks yesterday. Montreal Carabins will be in the dark blue. Montreal, of course, seated higher. And the Tommies ranked sixth coming in. So technically, Montreal will be your home squad tonight.
Actually, no, sorry. Stu will actually be the home team. Each team gets one home and one away game in this tournament. So tonight, Stu will have last choice of line change.
Line change. That's good to hear. Wolf getting the start in net for the Tommies again tonight.
Wolf was fantastic in the regular season for St. Thomas. She played she started 20 out of 24 games for the Tommies, a 2.04 goals against average, and a .929 save percentage across the ice, starting for the Carabins. Of course, their top goaltender, Elodie Rousseau-Sirois, who stopped all 24 shots, I believe, from Saskatchewan on game one. I believe it's 24. I don't have my notes in front of me, unfortunately. But in the regular season, Rousseau-Sirois starting 14 of Montreal's 20 games, an even 2.00 goals against average, and a .934 save percentage.
This is the final game of Saturday night here. After this game, we will know who will be playing for gold, bronze, and fifth. So here we go, folks, with Grant Harvey Center. Brewster lining up at the faceoff. Her fifth season, and she is the Tommies' captain and leader. She will take the draw up against Legault.
Referee tonight is Brittany O'Neill on the lines, Kelly Matthews, and Emily Bendel.
And we are off. Stu once again with no scratches. Apperson dumps it down. And this crowd, well, they'll be ready to erupt if Tommies can get something going against this top-ranked Carabins squad.
St. Thomas need a big jump here. They need to get the first goal because that's really, really important. But for Montreal, if they get that first goal, you could easily take the crowd out of it. St. Thomas's crowd got out of the game for a couple of minutes last night after Saskatchewan got two in a row.
Apperson now, that top line on Nick spoke about. They were Very hot yesterday. Appison almost turns it over the line, and she does, and it's a takeaway. The other way is Barker trying to split the D, and she almost does. Snyder pinches it back to Anderson. Anderson, nice flip past Appison. Brewster now has it. Brewster will shoot it off after that 40-second shift there, and they change. Second line coming on.
You mentioned it, Rob. Short shifts for the Tommies, but right there, great back check by Eliza Snyder. Talked to Pete Murphy before the game, and he said the key for them is going to be the back check and getting back on defense as quickly as they can to take away those angles.
Steinhardt being chased hard there, chasing after it now. Down low is Deschen. Steinhardt comes away with it, gets around Alamo, swings it up. Coming after it is McIsaac. She's working on Bro. Bro back. McIsaac swings it to Thompson. Thompson, nice little move there to get around McIsaac and Bro. Swings it back. McIsaac behind the net. Tommy's changing a few players right now. Thompson has it. Gates coming off of the bench, swinging right into the slot. Three Catabam players working in on Thompson right now. It gets back to McDonald. She'll poke it back in. Just about 2 minutes into this first period. High pace action. No whistle yet. Scott gets leveled hard, and she is in some discomfort. And she is on the ice right now. On her knees, mind you.
And no penalty call on that one. For Montreal, looking back at last game, I didn't necessarily think that Gabrielle Deschaine had all that great of a game. I was talking with a few other people around the Fredericton media too, and they agree with me. For Montreal, they need to get a big jump out of their captain early on to get some momentum. Granted, they have a lot of momentum in terms of the fact that they're the top team, or defending national champions and top seed in this, so tons of confidence from that team.
Scott skates off gingerly, but she stays on the bench though. That's good news for the Tommies there. And back forward is the Carabin. Coming down the ice now is Charlebois. She'll chip it in. Racing after it with speed now. Oh, good pressure here. Charlebois gets hit by the Duffield. Wolf makes her first save of the game off of Lanceline. And it's a good start there as she makes a save off of Lanchance. All the way down in the end. Back to center here. Ryan, she scored the first goal of this national tournament for the Tommies. She is back on the ice right now with McTaggart. And Francis. Beaulieu back for the Carabin. Beaulieu behind the net. Swings it across to Charlebois. Montreal a little bit stuck on their own end, waiting for options to get it out. Swings it over. Charlebois has it. Little touch pass trying to get to Lemieux. Steinhardt keeps it in. It hits Charlebois in the arm. It's kept in by the Tommy. Charlebois blocked in front by Lemieux that time. A couple good defensive plays there by the Carabin.
Absolutely, and for Montreal, you mentioned they're having trouble getting out of their own zone. That's just patience by this experienced Carabin squad.
Richelle the other way now. Gets it back into Tommy's territory. Scott back on after being nicked up a little on that last shift. Kept in by the 6'3" Baudry. And she is being worked on right now by Apperson and Ryan. No one can get the puck away from her. Hits Scott in the skate. Tommy's just barely clear it. Apperson flicks it down, waiting for her teammates to change. That top line is back on for the Tommies. Their second shift in the opening 3 minutes of play. Richard and Scott bumping into each other. Oh, Steiner clips the net. Tommies turn it over as it's Bro in the zone. Centered out front. Oh, and Wolf was prepared for that. Apperson, Anderson looking for the breakaway pass. Oh, and it just missed her. Good play there to break it up there by LeHoux. And it's a chance. Brewster all alone. Shot. And it's bouncing around the crease as sticks went flying and just stayed out of the net. Great chance for the Tommies there by the captain, Katie Brewster.
It was 3 inches from this Grand Harvey Center erupting.
And there's Anderson, tries to swing it out front, gets her own rebound, flutters on, and Sirois will cover up. And this crowd is electric.
That's exactly the kind of forecheck the St. Thomas Tommies needed early in this hockey game, and Katie Brewster almost sent the Grant Harvey Center into a frenzy. 3 inches down there on the goal line, and it would have been a much different story for the Montreal Carabins early in this hockey game, but a great play defensively by Montreal to be able to clear the garbage from outside the crease.
Look for that top line to play 20 to 23 minutes tonight there, as they're creating chances every time they get on. Marceline now takes a shot just wide of the net. And it looks like the Carabin will get it out here as Plante tries to get it out. Swings it over. Chasing down the ice now is Barker. She's 1-on-2. Tries to get around Amanda Burns. Stops up. Feeds it. Jelena. And it's a turnover. Here comes McIsaac, but she couldn't hold on to it. And it bounces down.
That's the thing for St. Thomas. Look for them to counterattack really well in this hockey game. Before that counterattack to work, you need to hit your passes on the mark. Play down low for Steinert. Now turnover in the slot. Quick Michelle on goal. Oh, and it hits the post.
Steinert in a...
Sorry, folks. We're trying to get the video feed back up. And for now, we'll try to play-by-play for you as if it was a radio broadcast.
And there's a penalty coming up here to the Tommies. And we're going to fool around with this. Right when this whistle comes by, we will get the video back up and running for you guys.
So penalty now coming to St. Thomas. It'll be the first one of the game. Off goes Amy Duffield, and she'll go off for body checking. Sorry, folks. We're still trying to see what the video feed's happening. And there we go. Just the HDMI cable came a little loose there. Sorry about that, folks.
Yep,
but if we can replay it for you, Montreal forcing a turnover in the St. Thomas zone and bringing one off the post was the Carabins defender. So Kristen Wolf down there being tested early. Shots on goal right now through 5 minutes. Equal at 3-3 apiece as the Tommies managed to clear it down the zone. But the Montreal Carabins, you can't discount their power play. You don't want to give them the chance to get on the power play. The number one man advantage unit in the country, 29.5% success rate.
And I think you mentioned the Tommies have one of the best penalty kills in the country, so it should be a good battle here. Brewster, shorthanded break potentially. Apperson trailing, shoots, blocked in front. Brewster swings it towards the net, and Sirois covers or makes the pad save. As that line, wow, and that was even shorthanded, folks. So Brewster, who scored a few shorthanded goals this year. She was on the prounce there. Coming back in it now is the Carabins. Swinging wide. Shot towards the net and just wide as that was a good chance by Garipé. Back to the line. Bolia stops up. McTaggart trips, gets back up. Bolia shoots, hits McTaggart's skate. And McIsaac's able to clear it.
Great concentration by McTaggart on that one to be able to track the puck again after falling down.
Beautiful play. Back in. We're 55 seconds remaining in the power play. 13:40 in the period. McIsaac trying to shovel it out, kept it at the line. Over to Bolia. Oh, what a play by McTaggart to break that up. And that's all hustle.
And she'll dump it down. That long reach by Cassidy McTaggart. What a great penalty kill by the St. Thomas, the eighth ranked penalty kill unit in the country.
Duval
in the regular season.
Swings it up. Scott will just pound that back down. 30 seconds left. As every time the Tommies get that down, the crowd erupts here.
Right now, you can't see it on the screen, but Eliza Snyder and Steinert are really communicating really well on that back end.
Coming back up with it is the Carabins, shot there by Robal. And we got a whistle coming up as Wolf makes the save.
And an uncharacteristic shot by the Carabins down there. I mentioned earlier, their offense, they like to bring it down deep, wait for their wingers to come back, and then slide it out front for a backdoor shot. Good glove save by Wolf right there, but the Carabins might just be trying to make her work early on.
Richard shoots it. Wolf covers up again. 10 seconds left in the power play.
And that's all St. Thomas needs. This would be a big penalty kill for them right now. Kenya Marceline needs a big face-off win here, but there's no one behind her, so you'll look for Snyder, who's lining up on the inside here. No, she doesn't win it.
Robal wins it back to Mantha. Mantha walking the line, shot. Nice pad save there by Wolf. Duffield about to return to the ice. We are back to even strength. The Tommies kill that power play, and Thompson is off to the races. Swung back. Here comes Bro, the 6'3" Carabins forward, who has just been trouble for every team. Back down. Tommy's looking for the change. Both teams. Snyder has it. 12:33 remaining. Gets it up to McTaggart. Bounces off her skate and back to Bro. Swings it to Charlebois. Pretty equal game so far on both ends. Coming down the ice is Lancelin. Chasing after it is Ryan. Turns it over to Lemieux though. Lemieux working down low. Good plusle there. Coming out with it is Charlebois. Trying to get around Scott. Scott will dump that out, and it just missed McTaggart. Going now, that is chipped down, and that no icing call as Sirois will come out and play it.
Really short shifts by St. Thomas, and look at the body language on both teams. I don't think Montreal expected St. Thomas to come out as hard as they did. Their bench is sitting, and I think they're kind of taken away with how tough the St. Thomas are being right now.
Lead pass, it chips off of Anderson's stick, and no icing call. She chases after the puck right now, is going in for it. Is Duval. Turnover and a shot just wide. As the Tommies had a great chance from the slot. Another turnover. Here's Anderson. Shoots it. It's hit a body in front and just wide.
Brewster accidentally got into the way of that shot. And Apperson on the far side corner. Lucky she didn't get a penalty as she drilled the Montreal player into the boards.
And finally, the Carabins come out with it now. And it's another turnover as Brewster tries to give it to Anderson. It goes all the way down. Cianoa has trouble with it. Anderson off the side of the net. And she's still hustling. It's a long shift for Anderson as the rest of her line mates are off. Anderson being shoved down there, and there will be a whistle as Bolia and Anderson did not move the puck.
If we get a shot over here on the inside corner, you'll see the St. Thomas fans banging their thundersticks up against the boards. What a great fan support they have here at the Grant Harvey Center.
Great.
All the fans are out here from
awesome.
St. Thomas, and this is a great atmosphere inside the Grant Harvey Center, and you know that the Tommies fans are feeding off it.
9 minutes gone here exactly in the first period. Shots all tied up at five, and we are scoreless right now. Tommy's in the Carabins territory right here. Marceline wins that draw. Back to McIsaac. Thompson couldn't keep it in. And back to the races now is Alamo, who scored in the first game, and it's an offside call.
You mentioned Alamo's. Look for her to have a big game for Montreal. In that opening game against Saskatchewan, she had a goal, but on top of that, she put up six shots on goal. That was a team high. She was tied with Kim Deschan. Alamo's had a consistently good game, but Deschan struggled in the first two periods, finally picked it up towards the end of the third period, and got some shots on goal over at Cassidy Hendricks of Saskatchewan. But look for Alamo's, who's lining up at center right now, to have a big game offensively, as this is Montreal's top line on the ice right now.
Just about the halfway mark of this first period, and we are scoreless.
Tyler scoreless.
We are tireless.
We are tired.
Deschen turns it over at the line, but they get it back. Here goes Deschen, and that's another offside.
Yes, great call by the linesman in front, and I think over there on the far side was Garipé, who got a couple of steps over the line. I wanted to wait until the midway mark of the first period to run it down, so here you go, folks. Here's the tie-breaking scenarios for this hockey game. If St. Thomas wins by two or more goals, they're going to the gold medal game. If they win by one, they're going to bronze. If this game goes to overtime or St. Thomas loses, they're done, and they'll be playing for fifth tomorrow. There's no scenario in this hockey game where Saskatchewan can play for gold.
And we will run that down a few more times in this game to keep you updated, but two or more, and we're off to gold. One, it's a bronze. Back behind the net, Robal turns it over, McDonald banks it off the glass, a good play, but it was too hard, and that will go down for icing.
I think she was looking to bounce it off of the defender's shin pads. Down there is the big number 81, Laure Baudry. And Laure Baudry, she's a big 6'3" presence in front, and I don't know, I think she might be a rookie or sophomore, but head coach Isabelle Leclerc hasn't really utilized her too much, only had 3 points in the regular season in 24 games.
Face-off won by the Tommies. Ryan gets it out to center. McTaggart almost blocked it for a break there. This third line for the Tommies have been playing well as well. Ryan chasing after it. Ryan only playing 9 games in the regular season, scoring her first goal of the season last night. And she is back on, and she is playing very well. Francis punches that in with her glove. Going off the boards is Bro. Swings it down low. Chasing after it is Legault. Steinert should be able to get to that first. Legault still on her tail. Dangerous pass by Steinert, and it's taken away. Miller will get it back. Miller did not see a lot of ice time yesterday, and she is on her first shift of the game, I believe. Turnover, shot by Duvall in the glove of Wolf.
Oh, a good track by Kristen Wolf, and I don't think she saw it all the way until it got to about the hash marks. But talking about the St. Thomas Tommies, I mentioned earlier that they need to have good defense from their second, third, and fourth lines. Now look for Emily Francis on that fourth line to really anchor and have that defensive presence. Because the thing with Francis is that she's a first-line winger, and they have her out on the power play on that top unit, but they need some help defensively from their fourth line, and that's why Emily Francis is back there.
Lemieux taking the face-off against Anderson. Brewster kicked out. They lose it. Tommy's in their own end here now. Lasseline changes it over to Lemieux. Got Chalabois out front looking for the pass. Tommy's turn it over. Here's Steiner. She's trying to find Anderson and just missed her, as it was a good stick there by Duvall to intercept that.
Steiner's got to have a little more responsibility and creativity to take that puck in herself.
A little bit of a battle here along the boards as four or five players are in there, and they will whistle that down.
Great pace by both teams on this one. And Montreal seem, again, I mentioned, they seem to be taken away by how hard St. Thomas is coming at them. And now Pilon Robert having some kind words, I'm sure, with Tia Anderson.
Pilon Robert, yeah. Against, facing off here against Katie Brewster.
And fans, you can tweet us at that. You saw our Twitter handles. We'll put it up one more time for you now. Please tweet us questions, comments, concerns at the Twitter handles you see on the screen.
Pilon Robert wins the draw. And Tommies do regain control of it, though. Here comes Snyder coming up with it. Banks it off the glass. It gets about to center, and Mantha will just throw that back in.
And they're going to call offside here, as I'm not sure the Carabins fully cleared the zone. I think Rika Pilon-Robert may have gotten a few steps over on that puck. But it's 8:43 to go in this first period, and shots almost even, 6-5 in favor of Montreal.
Pilon-Robert wins that draw, swing it all the way around. Chasing after it is Snyder. Hits a referee's skate and stays in. Snyder will have to turn back now. Try it again. Burns to Snyder. They're having a little bit of trouble getting out. Thompson will just flip that pass. Oh, and McIsaac. Oh, and she just missed the lead play. Back for it now is Mantha. Stopping behind the net. Passing it over to Pilon-Robert. Banks it off. Chasing after it now. Carabins have a little bit of a chance here. Rashad coming up with it. Banked off of Marceline skate. And that is shown back in by Baudry.
One thing the Tommies have done really well earlier in this period anyway is kind of faded off now, but they're forcing turnovers in the Montreal zone, which is great. But
Montreal just forced one there, and they get a good chance off, but just missed the net. Scott has to regain her stick. She gets up just in time, and what a save by Wolf off of, I believe that was Garipé. Beautiful save.
A defensive breakdown for the St. Thomas Tommies. No one picked up Garipé down there, back door, but Kristen Wolf bails them out. But that's the thing that head coach Pete Murphy said that his team had to look out for. Montreal's offense is predictable. Their bread and butter is down there finding that backdoor pass or that cross crease pass to the winger, and St. Thomas really has to be careful for it, because Montreal did it twice on Saskatchewan for two quick goals in Thursday's opener.
And here's a turnover by Carabins right now, and it's a shot towards the net. McTaggart racing in after it, stopped up by Alamo. Banks it off the boards, kept in at the line by Savoy. Tommy's in the Montreal territory right now. Haven't had a shot in a few minutes here. Alamo swipes at it. So does McTaggart. Chasing after it is Garipé, who just missed the goal in her last time. And she goes in again and backhands it just high over the net. Another great shift by Garipé.
Garipé had that top shelf wide open, and she just put it over the net. And the St. Tommy's Tommies catch a break.
And back, do you think Gabrielle Davidson would have put that in for McGill?
I think Gabrielle Davidson may have even tried to pick a top corner on top of that. She's got a howitzer of a backhand, if that's such a thing. I think Gabrielle Davidson proved that there is such a thing as that.
Leading the tournament, 4 goals here in 2 games. Playing for McGill. They'll be in the final tomorrow night at 6:30. Swung it around. Sirois comes up to play it. Sirois still hasn't allowed a goal in this tournament. McDonald swung it down. Tommies have come close a couple times. That puck takes a bad hop and right out in front of the net.
Oh, down there's an offside call, and I don't think the linesman was necessarily yelling it too loud, because Apperson heard it, but Brewster was waiting there at the blue line. I don't think she heard the referee calling for that offside.
6:36, Tommy's got their top line out there, still scoreless in this game. Actually, Pete Murphy decides to throw out their second line real quick, get those fresh legs out there, and it's back, and the Carabins win that draw. They're going to try to come away with it, getting a chance here now. That's Bolia with it. Swinging it back down to Duval. Back to Bolia. Swung it out. Tommy's playing a good defensive pressure here. McDonald will poke that back. She loses her angle here, and chasing after it now is Lancelin. She winds up, shot deflected and just wide. Chasing behind the net now is Charlebois. Duffield working in on her. Duffield, there's about 4 or 5 players again stuck behind the net. And it does eventually get out as Lemieux has it, but now it's pushed back in. Scott stuck up, and the line and the referee about to blow it just doesn't, and it's still in the corner. Finally, it goes back to Lemieux behind the net, and that could have been a call. No calls. The fans wanted it. Scott was hauled down. Back into the corner. Duffield just trying to get it out now, and she will. Chasing after it is Miller, who is slowing up a bit as Duval got back real quick there. Good hustle by the defender.
Oh, Miller went slamming into the boards. Unfortunately, that looked like it hurt.
5:30 remaining in this first period, still scoreless. Long shot on net. Wolf makes the easy save. McIsaac now, 1-on-5. She will just have to shovel that back into the Montreal territory. Deschen, nice little move. The captain of this squad gets it in. Chasing now is Alamo. She has a chance. Shot saved by Wolf. Gives a rebound up and covers it up in time.
Great heads up play by Kristen Wolf. And now down there on the far side, Thompson is having some words with Kim Deschen, the captain of the Montreal Carabins. But Kristen Wolf has been phenomenal in this first period. Great heads-up play, good rebound control, seeing the puck sitting down in front and making the heads-up effort to dive in after it.
Face-off, Alamo and Marceline taking it. Marceline has been not great on the draw so far this game, but Alamo gets kicked out, so she'll go up against Caribe. Turn, and it's a shot from the point. Mantha takes a shot, and it deflects right into Wolf's, and she makes another great save, her 10th save of the afternoon, the evening.
And a great save, a timely save by Kristen Wolf on top of that, because Kim Deschan was right there on the doorstep, looking for a rebound, and a good heads-up play by Wolf, not just to kind of pin it in between her armpit, but also drop down to the ground to not let go of that puck and make sure she falls on top of it in case she does.
Steiner, it's cross ice to McTaggart. Nice touch pass there. Over to, back to McTaggart. She stops up, tries a couple moves. Francis pinches in now. Francis gives it to Ryan. Ryan falls down. She's right on the puck. She swipes it over. Francis trying to get back to it. Garipay has it for the Montreal. So Steinhardt misses the pinch. And the Deschen tries to get out. But Steinhardt makes a nice play to hustle back.
Right now the Tommies just need to get out of this period. Looks like they've lost their legs late in this frame.
Haven't had a shot in over 7 minutes right now. 10-5 is the total. 4:31 remaining. Savoy can't clear it. And it's back in. Oh, she gets another chance. Barely gets it out as Francis has to help her out. And here's a chance for Anderson. She's one-on-one. Anderson, nice move. Around one, Anderson. And she makes a... Oh, and Sierwan makes a great save. Oh, what a chance there. Now Apperson has it. And she just swings and misses. Oh, it got electric in here for a second. And back in is a Baudry. She towers over Scott. Scott trying to work on her. Swings it down to Richard.
And there's a cycle game with the Carabins. Look for a backdoor pass. The Tommies have to pick it up.
Legault now cuts out. Tries to cut to center. Doesn't quite get through. Anderson trying to feed it to her captain, but Baudry with a nice play to make sure she doesn't get that pass off.
And Baudry kicks it back in as her and Anderson got tied up along there, and now someone lost a glove on the inside.
And now it's going to be a holding. Her glove, and there's a penalty.
It's going to go against St. Thomas. Oh. Holding will be the call. And down there, I'm not sure. It could have gone either way, but Paige McDonald was trying to sell it because she had her arm lifted up in the air.
She also lost her glove during that sweet sequence.
And a tough break, and I don't think Paige McDonald liked that call very much because her and the Montreal player were tied up, and again, that could have gone either way. Tough, tough break for the St. Thomas Tommies as, again, they need a big penalty kill here, and a big face-off win will start that one.
2 minute power play, 3:30 remaining in the period. Montreal 0-1 on the man advantage tonight. They're sending out that top unit. Barker's on now. Swings it behind the net. Jelena sitting in the slot. Oh, they almost got it to her there. So now there's two behind the net. Barker switches with Jelena. Trying to switch back. Legault is the other forward on. All the way is Barker. Takes a shot, tip in front, rebound, and Jelena scores the first goal of this game.
Great play by Jelena to crash the net to look for a rebound. Wolf made the first save and unfortunately couldn't make the second as she was down and out. That was a great first save by Wolf, though, with traffic in front. But unfortunately, that was a defensive breakdown by the St. Thomas Tommies, and I think Amanda Burns missed the mark. She was looking for the rebound, too, and never saw Jelena coming in behind. But a big goal for the Montreal Carabins. Now they can kind of settle down and realize and maybe play at their own pace. And that's how they win hockey games, is playing at their pace and really moving the puck well down low. And that's what they did during that power play.
Carabins score 30 seconds into that man advantage. They're 1-for-2 now. And the Tommies find themselves down 1-0 with 3 minutes remaining in the first. It's a turnover. Duval shoots. Blocked in front. Trying to hold the line, but they can't. Marceline's off. It's one-on-one. Marceline falls. Gets back up. And that is offside.
Yeah, there's going to be an offside, but also a penalty call. Marceline with a great jump, getting the tripping. Oh, no, there's going to be a body contact call. Is this against St. Thomas? It is. I thought Marceline was going to go draw a tripping call. Wow, I did not see where that play happened. Aaron McIsaac, the culprit right there, will go off for body checking. I didn't even see where that body check occurred.
No, the crowd is... I don't know if anyone saw it, but...
And Cassidy McTaggart is going to get an explanation here. But a tough break for the Tommies. Now they really need a good penalty kill like they had in the first earlier in the first period because they can't afford to go down 2-0.
2:45 remaining in this period. And the Montreal Carabins back on the power play after scoring just 45 seconds ago. Mantha shoots, tip, beautiful save by Wolf. Oh, and that was close to being 2-0. McIsaac loving that from the box. Here they go again. Touched up pass. Here's Garipe. She swings in. Centers it out front. Tipped off the side of the post. Swing back out front. What a pass by Deschen. And Garipe had a great chance there. 2:19 remaining in the period. 1:30 on the power play. Deschen stops up. Back down low. Garipe. Good sequence here as she gives it over to Alamo. Mantha wires up. And Wolf makes the save. It's a goal.
No, the referee blew the whistle, and that's going to get waved off. The goal light went on. The Carabins celebrated. And you see over there on the bench side, everyone's kind of complaining about that. But referee Brittany O'Neill blew the whistle before that puck crossed the goal line, and they're going to wave this one off. A huge, huge, huge break for the St. Thomas Tommies as that puck trickled behind Kristen Wolf. And the goal light went on. Everything, it was clean. The referee just blew the whistle quickly. And I can't express enough how much of a break that is for the St. Thomas Tommies.
Can they take advantage of that break now? 2 minutes left in this period. Carabins on the power play for another minute. Alamo back in, setting up now. Gives it back to Deschen. Just out of her reach. Ken Snyder clear it. Has a little bit of trouble. And, oh, just misses Wolf. Carabins about to set up here. Garipe. Leaves it to Alamo. Back to Bolia. Great stick there by Anderson. And she is trying to get past everyone. She'll stop up. Nice little move there. Killing some precious time. Gives it to Brewster. Brewster now being worked on by Duval. And Duval will come away with it. Duval out to center. Slaps it. Wraps it around the net. And they will go for a change. The second unit will come out now. Brewster. No call there. As you can hear the fans arguing that. Penalties right now. Yeah. 3 for St. Thomas, 0 for McGill.
And Kaylee Steiner went into the boards hard right there. Easily could have been body checking.
1:07 remaining in the period. 15 on the power play. Steiner trying to clear it. It's kept in at the line by Bro. She stops up, waits up, tries the cross-ice pass. Uh-oh, McDonald loses her, or Burns loses her stick. And that is just cleared. As McIsaac is ready to come back, we're even strength. Tommy's still in their own end, though. Bro, oh, pass, and it stays in. Duval now, cross-ice to Barker. She's got room. She's got time, and misses the net by about a foot there.
Great angling by Kristen Wolf to take away the shooting lane. And now here comes
McTaggart has a chance now. She stops up, and she couldn't quite get a shot off, as that was a great defensive play there by Bro. Tommy's, though, they're staying in this game. 20 seconds remaining in the period. Shots 14-5 in favor of the Carabins. Bro, 15 seconds left. Will the Tommies be able to get one more chance up here? Anderson tips it around one. Tries to go around two. Can't do it. Puck out of play with 6.1 remaining.
Tommies have a chance to get one last shot on here. We saw them yesterday against Saskatchewan. They dug deep and got one last shot. I think there's like 12 seconds left. They won the draw from outside the blue line or so, and then got it in deep and got a shot off. I think Kenyon Marceline may have gotten that last shot for the Tommies in the dying seconds, but you know what? Getting out of this period down 1-0 is all right. You know, once they get a power play chance, they were 1-for-7 yesterday, so the power play wasn't great, so you got to know that Pete Murphy emphasized that they need to take their chances when they get them.
Puck swung in. They did get a weak shot off nonetheless, and that does it. Score 1-0 right now in favor of the Montreal Carabins. Shots now 14-6 in favor of the Carabins. But Stu, they held on there. And this game is very tight for what a lot of people were saying. 1-0 right now for the Carabins. And this is going to be an interesting second period, folks. The way this goes on, it should be interesting to see what Coach Murphy comes up with in the intermission here. Wolf making 13 saves in that period, keeping her team alive.
You're absolutely right, Rob. I mean, if I'm head coach Pete Murphy, I'm telling the girls, you know what? That's okay. That was a good period. St. Thomas came out hard, but fell off towards the end of that frame, and unfortunately couldn't really hold off that Carabins power play. But all it came down to was a missed assignment on that one. And you know what? As long as they keep their head on a swivel, and down there, actually, you know what? It was Amanda Burns who unfortunately took the penalty. But before that, on her previous shift, she was keeping her head on a swivel down there in the slot area and really making sure that that she was protecting her coverage, because that's exactly what Pete Murphy was saying that the Tommies need to do leading into this one.
Tommies Okay, Tommy's only five shots, or Tommy's five shots right off the bat there in the first 5-6 minutes of the game, and then they only found, then they were only able to manage one more shot in the final 15 minutes. That's something that obviously has to be worked on in the intermission here, but nonetheless, I think the Tommies can only take away good things from that period, and the crowd here is engaged. We are going to have a very special guest coming on here for the intermission in just a second. But right now here we got 14 minutes until the second period starts. And there's nothing bad you can say about the Tommies the way they're playing right now. But another thing is that Sirois, the goaltender for the Carabins, she has yet to give up a goal in this tournament. Four periods now, and she has not allowed one goal. In saying that, there hasn't been a lot of shots towards the net from both squads that have played the Carabins. But nonetheless, how
are you going to find a way to beat CLI? Okay, we're going to have our special guest right now. So stay tuned, folks. And we're joined now by CLI.
For sure. They've got to tap into our resource. I mean, when university invests in coaches, they invest in high quality individuals also. So we do have a lot to do with high performance, and a lot of it is the quality of our support staff, which is exactly what you're doing. I also believe that a lot of our international performance in many sports are touched by the CIS in some form or fashion. I'm an age grouper, I'll swim at the university pool, I play soccer in the soccer field. So these are all a crucial part of the development. It's, you know, it takes a village to grow great performance, and the village university system is part, the municipalities are part of that, OTP is part of that. So a sum of everybody working together hand in hand produces what we're seeing at the Paralympics, at the Olympics, and so on and so forth.
Quand vous avez rentré dans votre position du chef du SEC l'année passée, vous avez mentionné que vous avez un gros plan pour la Ligue elle-même. On l'a vu ça cette année avec le contrat avec Sportsnet puis toutes les autres affaires que vous faites. C'est quoi le statut du SEC en ce moment?
Écoute, on a aussi une belle association avec Radio-Canada. Radio-Canada va s'impliquer de plus en plus avec nous. Sportsnet est doing a great job also for us. Mais l'année prochaine, on espère de rajouter un autre sport. Autant chez le côté français que du côté anglais. On a, je sais pas si tu te rappelles, mais il y avait une pénalité sur un athlète venait des NCAA revenu au Canada. On a enlevé ça, un nouveau plan stratégique où on va travailler beaucoup plus fort à aider à rendre l'expérience de l'athlète à l'université encore meilleure. On parle d'avoir un peu plus de rôle dans la société régionale, dans chacune des universités, qui aide au développement du sport. Mais pas sport juste pour gagner, mais sport pour la vie. Et que nos athlètes étudiants inspirent une prochaine génération. Et je pense aussi qu'on doit innover. Dans ma discussion avec les organisations sportives, Volleyball Canada, Hockey Canada, c'est de leur dire, servez-vous de nous pour innover et pour qu'on soit à l'avant-garde du sport à travers le monde. C'est ça, c'est l'université, c'est innover, être innovateur. Alors, nous, on veut faire partie de ce nouveau milieu-là. Ouais.
La règle d'éligibilité que M. Lafontaine y parle, c'est que les athlètes canadiens qui veulent aller aux États-Unis pour leur première année d'études, s'ils veulent revenir au SEC, ils ne perdraient pas une année d'éligibilité. Pourquoi c'était si important de ne pas punir les athlètes canadiens qui veulent aller aux États-Unis pour leur première année?
Écoute, moi, je le ramène d'une autre façon. Ouais. Moi, je dis plus, on a beaucoup d'athlètes aux États-Unis dans beaucoup de sports. Ouais. C'est de leur dire, écoute, revenez à la maison. Et si vous voulez, parce qu'il y a beaucoup de... Tu sais, ces étudiants-là sont jeunes souvent. Ils peuvent dire, ça a l'air tellement bien là-bas. Ouais. Même, des fois même à travers le pays, alors tu te dis, tu sais, avant il y avait une année de tu ne pouvais pas revenir. Pour moi, on doit faire revenir nos jeunes chez nous. Beaucoup plus que juste à travers le sport, tu sais. Ça devient des ambassadeurs pour le Canada, ça devient des ambassadeurs pour leur université, ça devient des anciens, des alumni pour l'université. Quand ils sont au Canada, leurs enfants vont rester au Canada. Alors pour moi, c'est très important de garder, et ce qui me réveille les matins, tous les matins, c'est de créer un environnement où on garde nos athlètes au pays, parce que ces jeunes-là vont être nos grands leaders pour le Canada demain. Et on doit investir. On a investi 15 ans dans le sport, au hockey, à la natation. Puis là, ils ont 18 ans, ils s'en vont. Alors, il faut vraiment qu'on travaille pour garder ces jeunes-là. Offrir des environnements et des championnats qui sont d'où si belle envergure. Et puis, qui vont vouloir dire à leurs amis, « Wow! C'est tellement le fun à venir à UBC ou à l'Université de Toronto ou à St. Thomas. » Moi, dire à leurs amis qu'ils restent chez nous, tu sais.
Exactement. You mentioned earlier the possibility of adding another sport, particularly in the Quebec conferences, I believe. What's the news with that?
Well, we're working with Radio-Canada, yeah. And we're going to try to figure out which sport. You know, you're dealing with women's hockey is one. Probably volleyball is another one that's part of the discussion. And so it all comes down to a few things. It comes down to what's the best market for them and Radio-Canada, and how can we... help develop sports in the country. Yeah. And the great thing with Radio-Canada, like Sportsnet, it's a station that goes across the nation. So the French Canadians in BC or Calgary, you know, get to watch it, which is really good.
On parle beaucoup des Olympiques, particulièrement parce que le Canada avec les États-Unis, c'est une si belle match, une si bonne match. En parlant de ça, quel rôle est-ce que le SEC prend à développer des Olympiens pour le hockey féminin?
Écoute, en partant, on a les fichus, les sports interuniversitaires, les champions du monde. Alors, il y a certains athlètes qui vont aller aux champions du monde universitaires avant d'aller aux Olympiques. C'est une belle transition parce que c'est un championnat mondial multisport. Il doit vivre avec d'autres athlètes, partager. Alors, c'est une belle étape. L'autre, je peux dire honnêtement que de plus en plus, on a une grande base de hockey féminin. La plupart de ces jeunes-là vont être touchés par les entraîneurs universitaires d'une façon, soit dans des camps régionaux, soit dans des... Et ils servent de nos infrastructures avec leurs entraîneurs pour des camps provinciaux et nationaux. Alors, pour nous, autant c'est de créer 30, 40 et 50 équipes universitaires féminines et de développer la profondeur du circuit, autant c'est continuer à investir et de développer des entraîneurs, justement pour qu'on puisse bâtir une équipe olympique avec des entraîneurs et des gens de soutien, là, physio, massothérapeute, qui viennent du programme universitaire. T'sais.
You've talked a lot about infrastructure and building it from the ground up. Looking at the crowds that you have out here in Fredericton today, how much of that is a reassurance that you guys are on the right track?
You know what? First of all, hockey is a great sport, but when you start seeing that type of numbers coming for women's sports, you know it's not only healthy, but it's also a growing chances. And you know what? It's also, I do believe it's also a one sport that will not only attract, but will become part of the Olympic movement in many ways. And I think these people see this thing. Yeah. It's a great hockey program. It's a great game tonight, but it's been a great, the last 5 years, the growth of women hockey has been brilliant. And you know, we talked about it yesterday too, but the Olympic finals was not just a turning point. I think it showed the strength of character of the Canadian team and the Canadian women's program, but also more than that, I think it shows that Canadians never give up. And and I think that's what we got to build on. We got to build on our toughness and on our greatness. You know?
Attendance at the Grant Harvey Center for yesterday's game, 1,414 fans, and against the St. Thomas Tommies and Saskatchewan Huskies last night, 1,522 fans coming into the Grant Harvey Center here in Fredericton, New Brunswick. We'll get the attendance tallies for you later on in the third period. Don't go away. We'll be back for the second period of play. Montreal up 1-0 on the St. Thomas Tommies. You're watching the 2014 CIS Women's Hockey Championships on CIS TV. Thank you very much, Pierre.
Thank you. Sit down.
Parce que c'est la première fois que j'ai fait un... Oh.
Welcome back, folks, to the second period of this final game of Saturday, March 15th, during the CIS 2014 Women's Hockey Championship. St. Thomas trailing the number one ranked and defending champion Montreal Carabins 1-0 after one.
Absolutely, Rob. And now for the St. Thomas Tommies, coming out of that dressing room, head coach Pete Murphy got right on the bench, and that team seemed more than enthusiastic to come out here for the second period of play. They had a great first period, nothing to shame themselves for being down 1-0. That's just a strong Montreal Carabins team who are number one in the country for a reason. They work that offense, and you know what? St. Thomas so far have done a really good job shutting down that Carabins offense. I said before, it's very predictable. They like the cycle. They like to bring it down low. They like to bring it back out to the corner and look for that backdoor pass, and if it's not there, they'll put it back up to the point and run it like a basketball drill. St. Thomas, though, good man-to-man defense and zone coverage, picking up the backdoor passes. Of course, unfortunately, they missed that first one off the rebound shot after Kristen Wolf made an unbelievable save through traffic. But full credit to the St. Thomas Tommies for shutting down the defending national champions in the first period. Let's see if they can keep it going.
Here we go, folks. Second period under, getting just about underway. Wolf making 13 saves in that first frame. Tommies will have to get more shots towards net, only generating 6 in that period. 5 coming in the first 5 minutes of play. The Carabins are back on attack right now. It's Alamo trying to chip it through center. Tommies also, Nick, without a power play in that first period. McGill with 3, capitalizing on 1. Shot, beautiful save there by Wolf with the pad off a point-blank chance by Alamo. And Tommies will ice it. So a great save early on by Wolf there, as she didn't have any rust after that intermission. 25 seconds in, faceoff will come back to the right of Wolf. Both lines staying on. Back to the line, Mantha shoots just wide. Bank back, Brewster to Snyder. Banks it all the way up, and that could go down for another icing. No, that will go all the way on to Sirois, and she turns it over. Oh, that could have been costly. Anderson now to Apperson. And that ref skate got in the way again. Anderson now trying to look for someone. Sends it out front for Brewster, just missed her. Back to the line is Steinert. Coming back, banked. And here comes Garipe. She's 1-on-4 right now, so she will just try to work something her own here. Dupere now chasing after it. Duffield gets to it. And the Tommies look to get it back out. They are on their second line change now of the period. Duffield tries to go from skate to stick, turns it over though. Coming back the other way now is Robel. Over to Richard, looking for Baudry. And a great play there by Steinert as she lays out to block that shot. Swapped around the net there. Baudry working on. As she gets it free, and now the Tommies are off. It's Gates. We'll just dump that off the glass as Anderson had to go to a change. Coming back now are the Carabins. Good fast-paced action of this second period here. 2 minutes in. Coming back now is Robert. She was trying to flip it over to Baudry, but couldn't. That goes all the way back. And that won't have enough for icing as Bro is back to get it. Swaps there with Delorme. Tommies turn it. Tommies steal it though. Thompson wraps it around the boards. All the way over. Miller trying to get to that now. And it's kept in by the Tommies again as Scott has it from the line. Shoots it. And it's a dangerous play here as I believe that Bro has a break. Baxter now shoots. Oh, and misses just high as that was a great chance trying to go block her side.
Great idea using Paige McDonald as a screen down there.
Tommies almost got behind two there. Chasing in now is Bolia. Bolia has the puck at the line. Switches over. Montreal looking good right now. Jelena scoring the first goal of the game. Well, the only goal in this game so far. Jelena back down low. Crossing with... just crossing back. She gets it over. Miller now has it, who's been on for a while. She will look to just dump that down and go for a change. As Montreal had a good shift there. Swinging it around the boards. McIsaac trying to intercept that. Being hustled down there by Bolia. Swinging out front. McIsaac just can't get it. She is tangled up. No call there as the ref did not put her arm up. Jelena banks it off. Kept in the line by McIsaac. Tries it again, and now it will be a no penalty
no,
there.
No, I thought there would be as well.
Wow, as it almost looked like a tripping, but Tommy's finally got a break there. Right now, it could be a 2-on-0. No, Charlebois is back. Nice hustle by Burns. And Wolf steers it aside with her stick. Bad line change for the Tommies there. Almost cost them. McTaggart, Lemieux now keeps it in. She's 1-on-3 though. She'll wait for help. Swings it out front, and what a save by Wolf as she makes a beautiful save off of Charlebois. Wolf now 16 saves on the game. Swings it back down low. Francis can't get a hold of it. 4 minutes gone in this second period, and we're still sitting at a 1-0 game. Burns. Good defense there. Now Charlebois trying to get a shot off. Lancelin passes it back to the line. Lehou being worked on. Oh, Brewster just missed that. That would have been a 2-on-1. Back down low. Charlebois has it again. Lehou waiting for the puck at the point. Crossed out front. Oh, and Snyder almost tipped that into her own net. That will be swung all the way around the net.
Oh, that should be too many, man.
Oh, and that hit the skate.
And the fans looking for a call there, but unfortunately they don't get it.
So Tommy still without a power play in this game. Kept in, nice pinch there by Snyder. She'll flick it to her captain. Alamo steals it though. Passes up to Deschen, the captain of this Carabin squad. Great action here in this second period. As the Tommies find themselves competing against the defending CIS champions. It's a turnover, it's a 2-on-1. Grape Skinny Pay over to Deshaun, back to, oh, and that's a breakup. Here comes Steiner. She goes over to Brewster. Brewster has Apperson, but she can't get it. She will chip that down and go for a change.
Great back and forth play and good response from the St. Thomas Tommies at the start of this period, being down 1-0.
Puck swung in all the way down. Wolf gets down on the butterfly to make that save, just to be careful. Thompson tries to bank it off the glass, doesn't really get out. DeLorme will swing it back in. 5 minutes in, this 5 minutes with only one faceoff so far. Banked off the glass, and that will be the second one because that will go all the way down for icing.
Again, like I mentioned, good back and forth hockey right now, but for the St. Thomas Tommies, that's exactly what they needed coming out of this intermission. Good, hard-paced forecheck against the Montreal Carabins, and sound defense going back defensively as well. Fans, if you missed it earlier, the breakdown for this game is if St. Thomas wins by two or more, they are in the gold medal game. If they win by one, they go for bronze. A win in overtime or a loss outright does them no good.
Wolf makes a nice save there off the shot by Barker. Banked it around the glass, kept it at the line, swung back, trying to clear it now is Steiner. She gets crossed up there defensively. Thompson, back over. Anderson now gives it to Marceline. The crowd is roaring every time the Tommies enter the zone. Marceline will have to backhand that behind the net. Here comes Duvall. She's coming up with speed. Doesn't really look where she's going, and it's a turnover. Thompson kept her head down that whole time, was Duvall. Oh, being wrapped around Bolia, putting the two arms over McIsaac. No call there, though. As the refs... back to the line, kept in there, and it could be a potential two-on-one. Here comes the Tommies the other way. Nice look. Oh, Gates gets shoved down, and that was a full-on body check, and there is no call. And this crowd is getting irate.
And Gates is lucky that she didn't get the retaliation call there, too, because she went back to that girl who knocked her down and gave her a nice little shove. Luckily, the referee wasn't looking at it, but, you know, Gates has got to have more discipline than that, because if the St. Thomas goes down on another penalty kill, unfortunately, Montreal, like I said, may capitalize because they have the best power play in the country.
So it's been a great, and it's getting a little rough here, and I don't mind a game like that either. Sirois, 4.5 periods almost now, where she has not surrendered a goal in this tournament. Tommy's trying to get it out. I mean, kind of Ben McDonald will go back for it. Banks it off the glass, doesn't get out, as Rochelle keeps it in. And there will be a cover up there because the puck was not moving anywhere.
In the first game of this tournament, and again in the second, I mentioned that if you have a hot goaltender, it can take you right through to the finals. Kristen Wolf right now is red hot. She's made 13 saves in the first 26 and a half minutes of this hockey game, but she needs to look for some help from her defense. Her defense needs to be in that blue paint area, cleaning out the rebounds, because that's the only goal she's given up so far.
18 saves for Wolf so far. She is standing on her head. A lot of those shots coming point blank. Tommies do have two shots in this period, but that's just not enough at the moment here. Francis tries to flip it up to McTaggart. Here comes Francis. She is being hustled from behind, and finally the Tommies will go to the power play.
And now we'll get a penalty call against Montreal, as great individual effort down there by Tia Anderson, or pardon me, that's Emily Francis down there. She got tied up with a Montreal defender and drew a great penalty. Got tripped, and she'll get a high five from Kristen Wolf as she goes off the ice. But St. Thomas, though, they were 0-6 on the power play last night until they finally got one in the dying minutes, 1-7. They can't wait for the dying minutes to get a power play goal now. They need to take their chances take advantage of their opportunities when they get them. This, Rob, is a great opportunity.
And the Tommies on their first power play of the game, and they send out Brewster, Francis, and Anderson. And they have, like Nick mentioned yesterday, towards the end of the game, they have Apperson running the point. So four forwards and a defense on right now, the defense being Steiner. That puck is not moving anywhere, and that's killing 20 of the seconds here in the power play. It's back to the line finally. Steiner flutters it down to Anderson. Anderson has a little bit of trouble with it. Gives it back. Francis swings it to Brewster. Brewster back to Apperson. Over to Brewster. Good setup here now. Apperson fakes the shot. Back to Brewster. Cross-ice pass. Steiner. What a save by Sinoa. And just wide as the Tommies almost put that one in on the rebound. It's back to the line. Anderson. Shot. And Sinoa covers up. And that was some good chances there for the Tommies.
The St. Thomas Tommies top line. Katie Brewster, Emily Francis, and Tia Anderson making it rain on goaltender Elodie Rousseau-Sirois on this one. And you see out there, Kelty Apperson working that point line. Katie Brewster had a great chance on the open net, but just put it off the side of it. But St. Thomas have Montreal on their heels right now on the power play, and they still have another minute and 17 to go.
12 left in the period. Murphy, Pete Murphy keeping that top unit on right now as they generated some chances there. Tommy's keeping it in as that's Anderson now working, coming out through. Can't clear it. Jelena now will get it all the way down, and now the Tommies will... Well, no, they will not switch their lines right now.
Jelena going off the ice, limping on her ankle. May have been a knee or something, but she is hurt over there on that Montreal bench. Maybe took a shot off the ankle or something.
Anderson, Apperson. And she gets hit, but that was a accidental contact, I do believe. Legault now swings it over. Tommy's having trouble getting it back into their end now, into the Carabin end. 40 seconds remaining on this power play. Almost a turnover there by Steiner. And how is that not offside call? She kept it in. Wolf coming out to play it.
Oh,
and that's a shorthanded
Kristen
goal.
Kristen Wolf and Pete Murphy over there on the side of the bench with his head down. Wolf came out and tried to poke check it instead of covering the puck up. And Thompson's actually going to argue with the linesman saying that how is that not offside? Because you said it yourself, Rob, that should have been offside. I personally didn't see it. I was looking away from the play. But Kristen Wolf right now, after having such a great game, stopping 18 shots, she gives up that one. And in to help her out, to give her a tap, to let her know that it's okay, is Aaron McIsaac. Because Kristen Wolf made her first mistake of the hockey game, and it cost the Tommies. First mistake of the tournament, unfortunately.
From just about tying it on the power play to giving up a shorthanded goal, the Tommies find themselves down 2-0 now with 20 seconds remaining on the power play.
So that goal unassisted, but again, that's the Montreal Carabins team. They force, even if they're on the penalty kill, they're forcing the forecheck shorthanded, and that's all that would happen there. They force a turnover at the blue line, and again, offside or not offside, we don't know. There's nothing they can do about it now, but what that came down to was Kristen Wolf. She's done so well staying in her net so far this game, and she's been making save after save, and that's all she needed to do. There was no need to come out and play that puck.
And Barker gets credited with the goal. Here's a 2-on-1 the other way now. Swings it over. Nice defensive play by the Tommies there as Alamo couldn't get the pass. The Tommies do not capitalize on that power play, and it's over. We are back to even strength. 11 minutes remaining in this second period. The Tommies find them down. 2-0. Swung out front. Alamo's shot. And Wolf gets the glove, and she gives a little stick there to Lemieux.
Now the thing with St. Thomas is that they defended that one goal lead or one goal deficit so good. Now they're in a whole two goals. And it's a lot bigger than that because they actually need three, because an overtime win does nothing for them to make it to the bronze medal game. They need to win by one goal, and they need to win in regulation.
Yep, the hill gets a little steeper to climb right now, but that's not over. We are halfway through this game. And the Tommies have been playing pretty well, minus that shorthanded goal a couple of minutes ago. Back in the slot for Lahou. She tried to get a shot off, but the Tommies, nice defensive play. Steiner now trying to clear it. Miller pokes at it, and it does get out now. Miller's with Duffield. Miller controlling the play. Back to Duffield. Duffield shoots, and Sirois with her 11th save of the game.
Now, the difference between Sirois and Kristen Wolf down there is you see Wolf coming way, or staying in her net to try and protect the backdoor shots. Meanwhile, Sirois coming way out of her net early to try and take away the shooting angles. Unfortunately, that's Montreal's offense, and it's forcing Kristen Wolf to stay back onto her post. But Sirois, luckily, having the luxury of having some good, like, some solid defense so far that she can trust behind her, and St. Thomas not necessarily looking for those backdoor passes, is allowing Sirois to have a little more flexibility between the pipes.
And we are 10:21 remaining in this second period. McTaggart coming out for the draw. And she loses it back to Lehou. Shots now, 21-11 in favor of the Carabins. Back the other way now. Chasing with speed is Pilon Robert, the second best name in this tournament. Pilon Robert. First, of course, Freiberger for the Golden Hawks. And that is swung back to center ice. Mantha now trying to clear it. And it gets back, and that will swung all the way back into the Tommy zone. No icing.
Penalty or power play woes still plagging the St. Thomas.
Yep.
Tommies 0 for 1 so far tonight. They're 1 for 8 in this tournament.
Back, and here comes Rashad. She'll bank it off the referee's leg, and it stays in for the Tommies. Good break there. Apperson now trying to take advantage of that ref. And that's a good shot blocker save. Blocked in front. Apperson now that top line. Back to Brewster.
Oh,
and how did she not put that in? As she can't believe Sirois gloved that down.
Sirois, a good heads-up play. You saw her back leg. She just kicked up and swung herself towards Katie Brewster, swinging her glove hand out there to take away the angles. And she just glove-handed that. But a close call for the Montreal Carabins right there as St. Thomas almost half that lead.
Sirois' best save of the game right there.
Best chance for the Tommies of the game, too.
Sirois now 90 minutes now in this turn without allowing a goal. And here goes Apperson. Blocker saved by Sirois. This top line for the Tommies have generated all the offense so far, all the scoring chances anyways. Anderson being pressed on, has Apperson with her, gets it to her. Apperson now being hooked, gets the puck away, cuts towards the slot, swings it to the captain, Katie Brewster. Katie Brewster, who just had that great, magnificent scoring chance. McDonald tries to pinch the line, couldn't hold it. Here goes Deschen. Swings it over to Grippe, and a nice play there by Scott. And going the other way is ball, but it hits Brewster's skate.
Thing with St. Thomas right now is, like I said in the first period, they need to have tape-to-tape passes, and there's one there.
As Brewster was at the end of her shift, so she just flipped that over. 8:35 remaining in the second.
Okay, they got the first part of their passes down, tape to tape. Now they got to have lead passes. A couple of passes so far in this game have been between a person's legs or behind them a little bit. Earlier, Katie Brewster had a great chance back door, but the pass was behind her.
Coming away now are three Carabins, led by Alamo, who will just shoot that in. Barely gets in, and here goes a chance here for Grippe. Shot, and I think Wolf got a piece of it, as Grippe had a great chance there. Kept in there. Two Tommies working in on Jelena. Jelena slips and falls down, but still gets the pass off. It goes out front, and Thompson has it for the Tommies. Tries to go around, couldn't find it. And Legault, couple nice plays there in her defensive end. Couple players running into each other. Going the other way now. Offside warning. And Jelena will go offside.
Great play by Eliza Snyder over there on the far side board. She takes the body on. Trying to go through my numbers again. Montreal have so many. Mo Jelena. She took the body on her over there in the corner, and actually Jelena ended up going in ahead of the puck, thinking, and then after that the puck sailed across the blue line. But again, a great play by Snyder to play the body and not let Montreal get another 2-on-1.
7:40 remaining. Tommies would be huge for them to get one, if not two goals before the end of this period. And here they go, coming out with it now. Miller has a little bit of a chance. Miller shoots. Saved by Sirois.
Good rebound control.
And Gates couldn't get a hold of that rebound as Sirois punched that to the corner. Kept in by the Tommies so far, though. And now going the other way. Oh, and it's a turnover. Nope, but now here comes the Carabins. Lancelot has it. Drops it back for Lehoux. She swings it down into the corner. And now the Tommies regain control as they try to go for the stretch passes. Duffield could not get to it. Steiner now. You'd have to think maybe Murphy... Coach Pete Murphy is going to start double shifting that top line.
Well, he's done it earlier this year. Kate Brewster, no stranger to double or even triple shifting.
Not at all. Alamos gets a shot on. Saved by Wolf. That was her 20th save of the game. Alamos swings it around. Deschen, the captain, swings it out. Good block in front there by Steiner as she is in some discomfort.
Tommies need a dime change desperately.
Duffield
They're
has
gassed.
Been, you're right. Duffield has been on for a while. She can barely even flip that to... And Miller will just punch that in. She needs to get off that ice.
Much needed line change for the Tommies. And here comes a fresh set of legs down there. Look at Ryan fighting down there in the corner.
And it's McTaggart's line now. She stands in front of the net. That's a good choice. The big 6'1" forward. Trying to screen Seattle. She gets pushed, shoved down. Gets back up. Scott pinching the line now. Good play by McTaggart to back her up. Francis gets hauled down there. As her and Deschen go down. No call either way. Off the boards, Francis chasing after it. Sirois trying to get that stick out of the way, and that will go down for icing.
Tough call by the St. Thomas Tommies. Trying to fight off another Montreal forecheck, and they're forced to ice the puck just to kind of give themselves a break. But a good play by that Duffield line earlier. They were gassed. They were out of, just totally, totally out of juice in the tank, and they managed to get the puck out without icing it. A great defensive play, digging deep and trying to find something on an empty tank.
Tommy's at one point being outshot by 13. They cut the lead down to 7. It's 22-15 in favor of the Carabins. Carabins counter with Baudry out there, the 6'3", 2 inches taller than McTaggart. McDonald now behind the net for the Tommies. Francis looking for that lead pass. McTaggart bats it down, as that probably wouldn't have got to Francis anyway. McDonald swings back. Touch between the legs there by Francis, but there was no one, and it's a turnover coming the other way as Robert. And it's a shot. Good block there by McDonald, as the Tommies are trying this stretch pass a lot right now. It does not seem to be working. Coming back is Rochelle. Goes cross ice, and it's just out of the reach of Jelena. McTaggart back on right now. You haven't seen that top line. Now they're coming on. That's Brewster. You're seeing Murphy switch up the lines maybe a little bit here. Going back the other way. Oh, and from her knees. Great chance by Jelena. And Wolf makes a great save off of the goal.
Holy smokes. I told you earlier, if you had a hot goaltender to take you through the tournament, again, Kristen Wolf is on fire right now. One pad save on one side, and then sliding across, jamming her pad up against that post. Her best save of the hockey game by far. And if it wasn't for that mistake earlier in this period, the Tommies could feed from that. But it's a tough hill to climb against the defending national champions.
And the Tommies win that draw, and they're going to try to get it back out here. And chasing after that is Apperson. That won't have enough gas for icing, and that goes right on to Sirois.
A lucky break for the Tommies that didn't go over to the side of the net for an icing call. But now they have a chance. That top line out there, Brewster, Apperson, and
Anderson.
Anderson, sorry.
That is, you're right, that line. If they're going to get one here, that's probably going to be from them. And here goes Apperson. She steals it. Looking, shoots, blocked in front. And here's another chance for Anderson. They can't find the puck. She had a great chance to put one on net there. You're right, though, Nick. That's another chance right there by the top line. They just got on for 5 seconds. Swung it down. Brewster gets pushed down. She's looking for a call. She won't find it, though. And she will be forced to get off. Going back the other way now are the Carabins. Legault dumps it all the way down. Chasing after that is Jelena. She won't catch up to it, and I think Steiner maybe thought there might have been icing. There isn't. Snyder flicks it up, but it's blocked down by Lemieux. Lemieux looking for the wraparound. Good play there by Wolf to cover the post. 4:11 remaining in this second period. Thompson looking for Marceline, gets it to her. Marceline, if she gets pushed out, there will be a penalty.
Great draw on the penalty by Kenya Marceline. That's just a case of one player being faster than another one. And in this case, I mean that Sarah Lachance is a faster skater than Kenya Marceline, because this Montreal team are very, very fast. But Lachance getting a little antsy there. She was just trying to angle off Marceline, but took her a little bit hard into the boards instead. But a great play by Marceline to draw that penalty. And now St. Thomas absolutely have to get something going on the power play.
And since that top line was just on, Coach Murphy will have to go with his second unit for the first little bit of this power play. And now, the other way going down is Duffield. She's looking to get around, and this swung back in by the Carabin, hits the linesman skate. Snyder trying to come out with it. Tommies can't get it set up in the Carabin end. Buck 38 remaining on this power play, as that puck is stuck at center ice right now. Trying to punch it in is Thompson. She almost wheeled her way into the zone. Snyder, cross ice to Scott. And it's blocked again as Alamo intercepts that. That top line's going to have to come on here for the Tommies, and they are. Bounced all the way down with a buck 15 remaining in the power play.
Francis is on right now, just waiting for Apperson, and now here comes Katie Brewster up there along the inside. That top line is out right now, and if Thomas is going to get a goal, they need to get one now because they're running out of time.
3 minutes in the period, 1 minute left in the penalty. Brewster spending a little too much time in their own end, trying to get it out now. Steiner to Scott. Anderson now. Will the Tommies be able to set something out? Bro, nice little hit there, I mean, for the no contact. And Anderson working down low. Brewster waiting out in front of the slot. She's going to go towards the behind the net now, trying to find it. Legault trying to clear it. Good stick lift there by Brewster. And they run into the referee, but it's a chance for the Tommies. Francis gets a shot. Sirois makes the save. Steiner, oh, what a play to keep it in. Winds up, shot, and it's a save by Sirois. And, oh, there's some shoving down there as Anderson, my mistake.
And Anderson's the only one who's going to get called for it here. She's going to go off for slashing. I'm not going to say anything.
But the crowd will say it for you. As the crowd does not like that call, and we're going to play some 4-on-4 for 30 seconds.
I understand that down there, first of all, going back, let's talk about a positive there. Elodie Rousseau-Sirois down there made a great save on Emily Francis, shutting down the pie hole. But just to give you a sense of how kind of the St. Thomas Tommies feel about that one, Pete Murphy is at the end of the bench right now, mouthing at the referee, just staring her down with laser eyes right now.
We haven't seen that for Murphy all season long.
Peter Murphy is, I don't want to say absolutely heated on the Tommies bench right now, but he's visibly upset.
Well, we're 4-4 now, so the Tommies had another great chance, but it's taken away by the penalty. Duvall, nice little move around Apperson, shoots just wide, going down for it now. Going down behind the net is Barker, coming back out with it. Barker scoring that shorthanded goal in this period. Swings it towards Garipe. Walking the line, the Tommies are having trouble now. Montreal is going to be on a 5-on-4 power play for a minute 30. Oh, and Bruce, that could have been a 2-on-0. Just barely missed it. 1:50 remaining in this period. Tommies found themselves down 2-0 still. McDonald tried to clear, couldn't get it out though. Kept in there by Garipe. Swing it over to back nice play by Gelina. Gelina with the first goal. Montreal setting up quite nicely here. Coming into the slot, nice pass down low as Baudry tried to find Gelina.
And there's the usual offense of the Montreal Carabins, going down to the corner, back to the point, back door.
What a save.
And getting a shot on. It's so predictable, the Montreal Carabins. And I don't mean predictable in a bad way. I mean predictable is very effective. The Carabins did that all game long against the Saskatchewan Huskies, and the Huskies couldn't stop them. The Carabins just kept going to that offense over and over and over again because they have perfected it. They're a one-trick pony, but they're a perfect pony, if that makes sense.
I love perfect ponies, you know that. 1:15 remaining in this period, 44 seconds on the power play as Francis is serving the penalty for the Tommies right now. Puck bounced over, Gelina gets it over to Legault. Legault up to her captain, here comes Deschen, she's got room. She shoots it, shovels it towards the net just wide. 1 minute remaining. Bro looks for a tip in front. Instead it hits Steinert and just wide. Tommy's trying to get out of this period, just down 2-0. Deschen steals it, over to Gelina. Back to Bro. Tees it up. Back. They set up, they're not shooting yet. 5 seconds on the power play. Shot tipped towards the net. Gelina gets a shot off, just wide of Wolf. Francis is back on the ice, 5-on-5.
And they have Francis for a stretch pass, so they can find her.
Oh, and that just missed her with 20 seconds remaining in this period. All the way down. Who will get one more chance? Steinert's glove falls off. She'll have to retrieve that. Now, 13 seconds left. Deschen shoots. Wired just over the net. Now we'll go all the way down the ice.
Oh.
And there'll be an icing call. 3.9 seconds left.
That's unfortunate. Anderson was looking for Apperson with a two-line stretch pass, and she just totally missed her. But now that sets up Montreal for a great chance at a quick goal here. They don't have their top line out. But if they can get a quick face-off win, then they might be able to make some magic happen here.
3.9 on the clock. Tommies win the draw. Moncton won't be able to get a shot off. Or Montreal. And that will do it as St. Thomas is down 2-0 to the Montreal Carabins.
And a bit of after-the-whistle stuff here. Anderson in there with the Montreal player in the corner. And Eliza Snyder, I don't know if Eliza Snyder is going to get a penalty or not.
Kind of looks like it.
Hang on a sec. The referee was talking with her as she goes off the ice.
Maybe just helping her towards the bench.
Maybe. I'm not sure. We'll wait and see if a penalty goes up on the board here. But that's a good response in the second period for the St. Thomas Tommies. Nothing to hang their head at. Honestly, that's a bad goal by Kristen Wolf to give up. She came out, if you don't remember, she came out and wanted to play the poke check on the puck and just totally missed, and the puck just sailed under her stomach. This could easily be a one-goal hockey game, and actually right now over there on the ice, Peter Murphy and his assistant coach are still waiting up, and Tia Anderson is still out there on the bench, as is Paige McDonald.
Wolf has not left the ice either. Interesting to see this from Murphy.
And Taya Anderson, this is why they're upset. Taya Anderson is going to get a 4-minute double minor for head contact to start the third period.
That is...
There was a skirmish down there in the corner, and that's exactly what happened. I think Anderson may have gotten a hit or two down there, but Pete Murphy looking for an explanation, but the only one getting it down there is Mifanwi Thompson.
We are going to be joined by a very special guest here, Danielle Goyette. Danielle Goyette, Olympic gold medalist here for the women's Canadian national team. She was assistant coach on this year's team, and we're very, very pleased to have her. She will be coming on in just a moment. As we can see, there is some argument over here. So it is going to be a four-minute penalty at the end of that period there to Thompson for head contact.
So unfortunate for the Tommies right there, but they're definitely going to have to find a way to kind of battle back in the third period. But remember, Rob, it's not just a two-goal deficit, it's a three-goal deficit for the Tommies, because they need to win by one if they want a shot at tomorrow's bronze medal game. And we'll just get set up here in a moment, but come back in just 1 minute. We're ready now. Sorry. So we're joined right now by the head coach of the University of Calgary Dinos, and a little bit more prominently than that, Olympic gold medalist Danielle Goyette. Danielle, thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Danielle, unfortunately, a bit of a tough Canada West Conference this year, but what have you seen from the teams out here? I know Montreal, you know them very well. How have they come out and impressed you in the first two periods of this hockey game?
You know what? They're playing a good game right now. They're really patient. They move the puck well, but we have to give credit to St. Thomas. They're playing a great game right now. To have a score 2-0 for St. Thomas right now after two periods is really good. You know, 2-0 is nothing. We know that anything can happen, and you know, it's just three goals. You need just one, and you get the momentum on your side, and everything can happen.
Danielle, you've been to a national championship last year. A lot of effort putting into Fredericton this year. How does this compare?
You know what? This is a great atmosphere here. Like, I love the rink. This is the perfect size for a CIS National Women's Hockey Team hockey tournament. And, you know, I'm here this week. I'm looking for next year, because we're hosting the CIS National. And for me, like, I'm looking at what they're doing well here, because we want to try to replicate what's going well and try to make it better for the athletes, because, you know, these student athletes deserve the best.
Is this your first time in Fredericton?
Yeah, no, you know what? I've been there. I've been here in the past, like long, long time ago when I was playing. But since I coach, yeah, my first time. Yeah.
Looking at this national championship, obviously a lot of caliber. Just going, speaking wonders for the caliber of women's hockey in Canada. I mean, you've been through quite a number of Olympics. A number of Olympians have played on your team, most notably Haley Wickenheiser, your friend, who I'm sure you recruited to your team last year. But that being said, I mean, over the years, what kind of a role has the CIS developed in kind of training Olympians in between Olympics to keep their game sound and maybe developing Olympians for the national team?
You know, in Canada, we have, like, good coaches, like, behind the bench on every university team. And our goal is to keep our best talent in Canada. You know, we have to fight against the money that they have in U.S., and that's something we have to battle with. But I think it's getting better and better. We have, you know, you need to keep one or two, and then the rest going to maybe follow. We have Haley Wickenheiser, like, she's, you know, fifth Olympic, and, you know, and I'm trying to work on her for next year, because she has one more year eligibility, you know, in the CIS. I'm trying to get her back on the team and, you know, recruit some players from, you know, Russia this year. And, you know, by bringing these players here, hopefully it's going to keep the talent in Canada, because, you know, we had good, like, good structure, good university team. And, you know what, we need to work, put some work into it, but, hey, we need our athletes in Canada. We have to do something with it.
Exactly. And switching real quick to the Olympics really quick, how is it compared being a coach to a player? It can it also in CIS hockey? Or?
You know, to be honest, it's not a big difference, because you prefer the same. Like, when you get there, you want to be the best you can be. You don't want to miss something as a coach. Like, you want to be prepared for all specialty team, all the players, who's going to be in that situation. And, you know, you have to be at your best at that time of the day. For me, I would say that the only difference, when you're a player, you take care of yourself only. When you're a coach, you have like 21 players you have to take care of. It's a little bit more work, but at the end of the day, like, you know, like, when you win as a player or as a coach, I think as a coach you have more satisfaction, because you see all the players having fun and then be happy with the result.
As a coach, any difference in nerves, particularly in that final game against the U.S.? I'm sure you've told the story over and over again to friends, but kind of walk us through that for our viewers. How was that whole experience, especially in the final game, coming back the way you did and eventually winning?
You know, it's funny. In the final game, I remember 5 minutes, I was really focusing on, you know, which player I'm going to use, because you have to be strategic on, like, who's going to be there in the last couple of minutes of the game. But never one time in my mind it said, like, you know, sometimes as a coach, say, okay, it's over. What am I going to say to the team after? Like, what am I going to say to the players? But nothing, came to my mind. Like, I was really focusing on the task. But one thing I had the feeling is like something's going to happen. Yeah. I didn't know that would happen, you know, but I knew something could happen, like would happen. And, you know, if it was one goal, but we would finish the game with a battle. Yeah. And we have to give credit to the Midget Alberta, Midget AAA team in Alberta that give us like games that, you know, we play from behind like a lot during the season. We used to be in that situation and never give up. And that was the thing we talk about before the game. It's like, you know what, no matter what's going to happen on the ice tonight, we're not going to stop until the buzzer like goes off. And you know what, and we have to give credit to the players because nobody on the bench put their head down and say, you know, it's over. We all believe that something could happen.
And how long did it take for you and your players to gel with Kevin Dineen? He came in late and, you know, he was the head coach. Did it take a while for you to gel with him, coach?
No, it was really easy. Like, you know, he's a great person. But Kevin didn't come and try to change everything on the team. We had a good program there. Everything was going in the right direction. The players were in a good shape. We just have to make sure that we stay on track with the goal like we had in mind and, you know, stay focused on that. And he trusts the people around him. Like, that's what it's important, because when you come at the last minute, you have to make sure that the people around you do their job at their best. And that's what he gave a chance to these people to do. At the end of the season like that, like, players are ready. You know, for me, you could pretty much put anybody behind the bench at that point, you know, at the Olympics. And, you know, at the end, it's the players doing the work on the ice.
At any point kind of leading up, was there any uncertainty, especially during that transition of coaches, bringing in a new coach so close to the Olympics?
You know, it's always like, you never know what's going to happen. But at the end of the day, you know, we have a job to do. Hockey Canada make a decision and we have to go with it. And it's like a player, you know, a staff is like players. Like, coach going to make a decision, it doesn't mean you're going to be happy with it, but you have to respect it. And as coaching staff and staff around, that's the same thing we have to do. We have to respect the decision they made and move forward and make sure we work in the same direction.
With your past, were you in discussion for the head coaching job for that Olympic team this year?
No, you know what, like, I did not talk to them. And for me personally, I could, to be honest, I thought it was better to bring somebody from the outside, to bring some new blood and start from fresh and, you know, keep going. Because, you know, sometimes you can make a change in the coaching staff, but for me, that was not the best decision it would have been, like, to do. But
So that being said, being at your first Olympics, even as an assistant coach, what kind of things did you learn from your first Olympics experience as a coach that you bring back to the University of Calgary?
A lot of work. You know, I don't think we can go through 2 years in a row, like, working the way we work. It's a lot of work, you know, like, never... As a university, you're going to have to do so much for a team. Learn how to work with other staff. Like, you know, we had a staff together. We've been working for 2 years together. But how to trust each other, to trust them that you're going to do the best thing for the players. Like, we have an off-ice training, Adam Douglas, that, you know what, we had to trust him that he's going to do the best for the players to be ready for the Olympics. Not to peak in November or December, but to peak in February. Yeah. And as a coach, sometimes I say, hey, I want to win now. Like, you know, you have to be patient. But at the end, sometimes confidence, it's hard. It's not something you just turn a switch and it's going to happen. But that's why when we went to Austria, that's when the switch happened with the team. And we started to have confidence and the players are starting to play better. But I would say, you know what, it's the way you work with people around you and trust them, they're going to do the best job. That's what I learned the most. Yeah.
Being on the inside with Hockey Canada, how much does Hockey Canada rely on the CIS to be able to provide the necessary training regimens and facilities for the Olympians who do choose to go back and go to school in Canada between Olympics?
They rely on them like a lot. Like, if you think about it, like, we had three staff we started the season was three coaches from the CIS. Like, that showed that, you know, we have good product, we have good quality of coaches, we have good players. Right now, we just have to make sure, like I said, we keep our best players, because our best players are going to raise the level of hockey and it's going to make the other players better. And if we, you know, if we're capable to do that in the next couple of years, this league is going to grow like pretty fast.
Yeah, exactly.
That's great. No.
And just seeing the amount of fan support here out here in Fredericton. I mean, we spoke with Pierre Lafontaine a couple of times this weekend, and just kind of the plan that he goes in is second to none. He's done such a great job already. Is it reassuring for you being so devoted to women's hockey in Canada and seeing the amount of fan support that a community like Fredericton has for its women's hockey team?
You know, I like to have like a championship in a small town, because you know what? This is what it's important right now in Fredericton. Like, sometimes when you go in the big town, it's harder because we have, you know, people, other things they can do, and sometimes you get lost in the event. But when you come in small town like that, I feel like, you know, when I play and when I coach, this is the best experience you can have for athletes. But, you know, sometimes you want to expose the athletes to the bigger town to see what we can do. And that's our challenge next year in Calgary. This is a big town, and we have to make sure we put a good show and make sure the players remember that tournament. Yeah.
Danielle Goyer, of course, the assistant coach, gold medal winning assistant coach on Team Canada's Olympic hockey team, who came back to win against the Americans, of course, I'm sure we all saw it. Does St. Thomas have the same magic in them to come back against the defending University Cup or defending CIS champions? We'll find out. The third period is up next. You're watching the 2014 CIS Women's Hockey Championships on CIS TV.
Thank you, guys.
That was awesome.
That was great.
Welcome back, folks, for the third period action. The Tommies are trailing right now 2-0 against the Carabins de Montréal. And we just had a great interview with Danielle Goyet. We caught talking to her a little bit after the interview, so sorry for no, pre-period talk.
Oh, yeah. When you get a chance to talk to a multi-time gold medalist like Danielle Goyet, she's just so interesting to talk to, and some of the great stories that she has to share, you definitely want to stop up and listen. But we got a great hockey game in front of us here. St. Thomas, unfortunately, on the penalty kill for the next 4 minutes. And I think actually Mufunwi Thompson has gotten ejected from the game. Actually, I don't know if it was Thompson or if it was Anderson. I think it was Anderson, because right now Snyder is in the penalty box serving the penalty. So Anderson may have gotten ejected from this one.
Yeah, there was a crazy finish at the end of that period with the referees talking it over for a while and a lot of confusion. But right now the Tommies are on the penalty kill for 4 minutes. That's what we know for sure. That's not a great start for them, being down 2-0 as it is. And they're going to need, I guess you could say, a miracle. Mantha swings it back down. Barker. Zelenov. Zelenov and Barker, the two goal scorers in this game. Barker comes out, tries to go up high, and not sure what the whistle is there, as that may have hit a glove, but nonetheless, there is a faceoff coming up.
Just going back to that last penalty, I don't see Tia Anderson anywhere on the St. Thomas bench, so I think she may have gotten tossed from this game because Snyder again is serving the penalty, and that's a huge loss for the St. Thomas Tommies. Tia Anderson, a crucial playmaker on that top line with Kelty Apperton and Katie Brewster. Anderson in the regular season, a 10-point scorer, so that's a huge loss for the Tommies top line.
And, yeah, you make a good point there. Now Alamo's coming back in. There's a 2:53 remaining on this power play. Swinging it back down. Scott gets a stick in there. Nice little play there. Coming back is the captain, Deschen. Deschen playing much better than the first game as she is setting up the play right here to Alamo. And Alamo gets a shot off. Good save by Wolf. Back to Deschen. Centered out front. And Garipe makes it 3-0. What a tic-tac-toe play.
Another defensive breakdown for the Tommies, unfortunately, right there. You said it perfectly, Rob, a tic-tac-toe play, and nobody caught the backdoor player for the Montreal Carabins. I think the goal scorer on that is Audrey Garipe. I could be wrong, though, but you're nodding your head, so I'm going to go with that.
Garipe, yep.
But now it's a huge hill for St. Thomas. They need 4 goals to make it to the bronze medal game, and actually that just gave a huge boost to the Montreal Carabins. Down there in the net, Elodie Rousseau-Sirois, the goaltender, as soon as the puck was dropped, she slapped both of her posts, came out, scraped her skates on the ice, and she's fired up, as is the whole Montreal team. But St. Thomas not giving up. They're all standing there over the bench. This is a long third period, but they need 4 goals.
And that, obviously, the power play is still going on. 2 minutes on it. So that was a power play goal, and the Carabins go right back on the power play. That four-minute major being served by, four-minute penalty served by Snyder. So the Tommies find themselves down 3-0 right now. The score that Carabins won by in their first game. Here comes Marceline, and she has a break. Marceline takes a shot, and Sirois looks to drop it. She can't, and that will be a faceoff.
And great play by Thompson down there, over there to stop that puck on there, or to force the pressure down there on Elodie Rousseau-Sirois and force her to make a save. And then another good play by Thompson not to engage into the physical stuff with the Montreal defender. 17:54 to go. St. Thomas still on the penalty kill for another 1:19. Face-off one down there by St. Thomas and controlled by Apperson. She'll take it into the corner but loses the handle on it as Jelena takes it back behind the net and the Carabins start up ice. Far side for Barker. Two-line pass down there for Legault and she gets around Scott. Taking it into the corner. She has room out in front. She'll look for a pass and dump it off down there for Girois and now picked up by Brewster and she'll clear it all the way down ice. Sirois. Saucer pass out there to Barker. One hand on the stick, she'll take it far side, across center ice. Pressure down there by Apperson, but she'll take it across the blue line. Stops up, high slot, looking for a shot, but she gets tangled up. Now Barker, down there on the inside hash mark, cycles it back around the net. She has Legault on the back door, sends it back up to the point for Duval. Looks for a shot through traffic, misses wide right, bounces off the back of the net, and cleared away to the inside boards by Scott. Now Apperson, trying to tip it out, but it's kept in by Bleau. Down there, in the slot, Jelena, looking for the post side, but couldn't get it away. Bleau now, pinching from the blue line, battling with Apperson down there on the hash marks. Now back to the point. It's Mantha. Over there for Bleau now. Shot, no traffic in front, an easy pad save made down there by Wolf. Rebound goes to the far side. Cycling it are the Carabins as Brewster steps up on Barker, who shuffles it back up to the point. Now Bleau, looking for a shot. Back door over there for Jelinek. Shot on goal and blocked in front by Scott as St. Thomas will finally clear it out. 1 second left and out of the box comes Snyder. Not a bad penalty kill by St. Thomas, only giving up 1 goal, but now the deficit is 4 as they need 1 to take the lead. Or they need to win by 1, pardon me. Turnover at center ice. Off the bench down there comes Emily Ryan. Far side, two-line pass by Steiner off the board. She was looking for McIsaac and misses her. Now Duval, ring it around over there for Baudry. takes it up across the center right or into the neutral zone, stick handling, trying to get around Steiner, but she'll just shuffle it into the zone. Down there is Savoie, back behind the net. Trips up with Richelle down there, and in down there battling is Ryan as well. Shuffled along to the far side. Francis hustling to get there, but Delhomme gets there first. Now over there to the inside, Steinert battling in the corner with Richard. Puck swung back behind the Tommy's net, and it'll be picked up by Emily Ryan. Takes it up into the neutral zone. She's hassled by Baudry, loses the handle on it, but back there to back her up is McIsaac. Now Leroux, oh, she gets stood up by McIsaac at center ice as the Carabins dump it into the zone. 4.5 minutes into this third period, still 3-0 for the Carabins. It's Francis now with the puck at the blue line. Another turnover, and there's a down Carabins on the ice. That's Alice Lemieux. She got tangled up with Amy Duffield, and they're calling for the trainer.
Thank you very much there, Nicholas, for taking over for a few minutes.
No problem.
But you're right, Lemieux is down, and there is a trainer on the ice. That's never a good sight. So Tommies did kill the rest of that power play, so that's good.
Yeah, they did. They only gave up one goal, which I was saying was a good PK, but still, that one goal is a bit of a stinger terms that it makes it a four-goal deficit now if they want to make it to the bronze medal game, because, again, going to overtime is just as good as a loss. But Lemieux got hit hard down there. She seemed to be looking at maybe her shoulder because she may have slipped out of place or something.
Yep.
I don't think so. Actually, I don't think it's that bad because she was putting weight on it, but she seems to be kind of inching her shoulder back and forth down there for a sec, so... We'll take a bit of a quick break now, and she gets up off the ice, so good to see from Lemieux. But yeah, definitely looks like a shoulder injury.
So sorry?
Oh, I was going to say, well, for Lemieux, looking at her stats right now, not a noted goal scorer, only had 4 points in 20 games in the regular season, but a strong defensive presence on that fourth line for Montreal.
Give her credit there for staying on the bench, being looked over by the trainer, but I'd expect her back in this game the way it looks right now. 15:30 remaining in this third period. Tommies, the home squad, find themselves down 3-0. Burns chips it down. McIsaac chasing after it. Good little play there, but it's a turnover. And down the other way. Oh, got nice little chance there, but Burns takes that back. Swings it to Snyder. Tommies are going to have to go on the offense here. And it's a turnover, but LaFlance runs into Alamo. Snyder being tangled up by Alamo. Chalabois comes in to help out, swings it out front towards the slot. McIsaac for the Tommies will look to get it out. Swings it in the direction of Thompson, but doesn't get to her. Nice little play there by Delorme. Swings it across, entangled up by Brewster, and it's a good play. Coming back now is Alamo. All the way back in. Tangled up again by Brewster. Brewster playing very well defensively right now. But she's going to have to get one on the score sheet to help her squad right now. And Brewster, Anderson, and Apperson are on right now. All three of them, top line. Here they go. Apperson, around one, almost falls, gets back up, swings it to Anderson. The crowd going crazy as they want to see the home squad get put one in here. And there will be a whistle.
A whistle, touched up. This could go either way, and it's going to go against Montreal. Good play down there by Kelty Apperson to fight for it. And I think I didn't really see much of a hook. Kirika Pilon-Rabert will get 2 minutes for hooking. And now St. Thomas, they're running out of time. 14:15 to go in this hockey game. They need to get a goal here. Out there for St. Thomas, Steinert, Francis, Apperson. And sorry, actually, Anderson is still in this hockey game. So that's weird. I don't understand why she got 4 minutes. Maybe it was actually Snyder who did get the 4 minute penalty, because at the end of the period they announced that it was against Apperson. But nonetheless, like I said, St. Thomas absolutely need a goal here because they are running out of time.
Well, they keep it in the territory. Anderson looking to set up, swings it back, shot towards the net, tipped by Brewster as she tried to go behind the back there, and that just missed the side of the net.
That was about 2 inches from the Grand Harvey Center erupting again, and Katie Brewster in what could be, or no, she'll have another game tomorrow, but. This is the last really meaningful game. I mean, not to say that finishing fifth place isn't meaningful, but in all honesty, you want to win a medal. Those are the games that mean something.
Of course, Steinert now coming up through center. Looks, sees some openings, keeps going. Steinert still going. Shovels it towards the net, tipped in front. Brewster taking Steinert's point, and she shot deflected way out. Almost hits Athletics Director Mike Eagles.
Yeah. Well, I think there's a glass panel back there, but good power play so far by the Tommies, and both fans appreciating the effort. But full credit down there to the Montreal defense, taking away the passing lanes, but they gave up a little. They faltered a little bit down there in terms of Brewster, being wide open on that back door. And again, it's just St. Thomas having the inability to get crisp passes to one another.
Tommies lose that draw now. They'll be forced to retrieve that puck in their own end. Chasing after it, though, is Deschen, and she will get to that puck first. Good play there by the captain of the Carabins. 1 minute remaining on the power play, 13 in the game. Going behind the net is Scott. Stops up. Passes it to Snyder. Snyder looks wide for Marceline. Doesn't quite get to her, though. Swung back down the ice. Backhanded over there. Thompson swings it in the middle of no man's land. There are 40 seconds remaining on the power play. Tommy's not really been able to generate much. Here comes Snyder, though. She'll stop, wait for teammates to set up. Not a bad play there. Swings it to Thompson. Thompson lets it go for McIsaac. Shoveled around behind the net. A little bit of a pile up there. 20 seconds remaining on this power play. And Ryan comes in to help out. Gets it back to Scott. Thompson, nice little toe drag there. Holds on to it. Swings it back in Ryan's direction. Ryan out front. Almost got a tip there by McIsaac. 5 seconds remaining on the penalty to Pilon Robert. And she will enter the ice as the Tommies were unable to score on that power play.
A missed opportunity for St. Thomas. Now they have 12 minutes left in this hockey game to get 4 goals.
Pilon Robert right out of the box. Almost had a scoring chance there. Intercepted by Snyder. She is going, the defender here. Turns it over. And here comes Lancelot. Nope. Ryan with a nice stick lift. 12 minutes remaining in this third period. Tommies still down 3.
The difference with the St. Thomas Tommies team right now is they came out strong in the first period, strong in the second period, but they faltered in the third. Granted, it's hard to come out strong when you're shorthanded for 5 minutes, but here they go strong now.
Steinert pinching in. You're seeing the D pinching a lot for the Tommies. They'll obviously need that right now. And that puck goes out of play.
They had a 4-on-2 coming back the other way, and Francis tried to find McIsaac, or pardon me, McTaggart. Over there on the inside, but again, it's the inability to get tape-to-tape passes, and when they do get the tape-to-tape passes, it's the lead passes which are hurting the St. Thomas Tommies. That's all that's hurting their game right now. They've had a lot of great scoring chances, especially in the second period, but what's hurt them is just missed passes.
Yep, and they find themselves trailing right now by 3. Apperson tries a swinging shot, but it gets blocked, and then it's out of the play. Out of the zone. A little bit of a pile up there at center ice. McDonald trying to shovel her way in. Thompson helping out now. Back. Apperson pinching in. Apperson tries to make a move. That puck's just not going anywhere. She falls, so now Anderson can't go into the line. Steinert banks it off the boards. Turnover, though, as it gets to the line, and the Catamount will just dump that in. 10:50 remaining now. Anderson shoveling it. Can't get it back. Bro, back, and there's going to be a delayed penalty here to the Tommies.
Against St. Thomas, and it's going to be against Kelty Apperson. She's going to go for slashing. She broke her stick in the process. I didn't see the play, but an unfortunate call for the Tommies as they're going to go back to the penalty kill with 10:49 left in this hockey game.
Yep, Tommies don't have a lot of time
left.
That's
not Apperson. Sorry, that's Anderson.
So Anderson goes in the box for 2. Carabins with the power play goal already in this game. Marceline taking the face-off. She'll be up against Gary Pei, who has a goal in this game. Back behind the net. Snyder turns it around. Marceline trying to get it out, but can't. Duval holds the line. Deloche now, the captain for this squad, swings it back. Alamos coming out in front of the net, circles it out front. And Garipay couldn't get a shot off. Deschen over to Duval. Shot towards the net. Wolf makes an easy save, and that is shot all the way back down the ice. Sirois, haven't spoke too much about her there, but she has made 20 saves in this game without allowing a goal in this tournament. If she makes it through this game, that will be 6 straight periods. Thompson pushes that down the ice.
Now, I understand the need to clear it out of the zone when you have a penalty to kill off, but St. Thomas has got to dig deep here in the third period. Only 10 minutes to go, and they need to find some magic. Down 4 goals, essentially, if they want to make it to bronze.
Tommy's trying to get it out, but it's kept in. Here goes Alamo. She walks to the center, takes a shot. Pad save there by Wolf. McIsaac falls while clearing attempt, so it stays in. Deschen now has a chance down low. Swings it over, but the Catamount can't get a shot. Good play there. McIsaac looking for McTaggart, finds her, but it bounces off her skate again. We've seen that a few times from McTaggart today. Shot down by Bon. swinging after it is Pilon Robert. Kept in at the line there by Bro. Swinging over for Baudry. Baudry has Richard with her, finds her. Nice little play. 20 seconds remaining on this power play. Tommy's can't really get a hold of the puck right now. Swung off on Baudry, takes a swipe at it. McTaggart takes a swipe to try to clear it, but can't. Baudry keeps it in. 10 seconds on the power play. Shot towards the net, and Wolf covers up with 9 minutes remaining.
And a bit of frustration for the St. Thomas Tommies, and Amanda Burns is lucky that she didn't get a penalty as she went and cross-checked Anitha Lucaletti right in front of the referee, and the referee warned Burns just after she did it, but I think if the referee wanted to really call something again, it would be kind of on both sides because it's getting pretty chippy here in the third period, and I mean, you can imagine that they want to settle them down a little bit before it gets out of hand.
Anderson back on. We are at full strength. They're kind of unable to score that power play. 8:40 remaining. Tommy's trailing 3-0. McDonald over to Steiner. Brewster banging her stick, but she wants that pass. And that's a nice pass. Here's Apperson. Shoots. Blocker saved by Sirois. As the Tommies are getting their shots now. They're 22 in the game. Trailing the kind of man by 8 in that category. Oh, that's going to be... No hand pass because, sorry, it was in the defensive zone. Coming back with it is Lemieux. Passes it over. Doesn't quite get to anyone. It's Anderson. She has a chance here. She's one-on-one. Tries to make a move, but good... Good poke right there by Bro, who's came off the bench.
Great poke check. Getting back, trying to, St. Thomas trying to catch him on the line change. And now the Tommy's going back to the penalty kill. Down there is Paige McDonald, and she'll go, or pardon me, that's not Paige McDonald, that's Stephanie Gates, sorry. And she'll go off for tripping, and that's just a great play over there by Charlebois to use her speed to draw a penalty. And again, the Montreal Carabins are so much faster than the St. Thomas Tommy's on many accounts, where most of their lines are. And again, Gage just unable to catch up down there to Charlebois and draw and takes a penalty for it.
All these penalties are, of course, not helping the Tommy's case right now, as it's hard to try to score a goal when you're playing one man down.
8:02 left to go in this third period, too.
And back to the power play, the Carabins go. Captain, oh, Bro can't hold the line. McTaggart chasing after it. Won't be able to get it as Duval is back first. That penalty is to Gates, 2 minutes. And now the Carabins try to put this one away for good. Swinging down the ice, Legault gets shoved off by Burns, but kept in by Jelena. Legault has time. She gets the puck back, can't quite hold on to it, but it bounces right to Barker. Barker with a shorthanded goal in this game. Back to the line for Bro. Nice little behind-the-back pass to Barker. And McIsaac can't clear it as that barely held the line. And McTaggart will push that one down a bit. 7:15 remaining. 1:15 remaining on the power play. Tommy's looking to clear it, and that will be an offside call as Jelena touches up.
St. Thomas, I've said it time and time again, they are running out of time. 7 minutes and 10 seconds. They need to dig deep. If you're tired, but you have Montreal on a line change, you got to get down there in the zone, get some shots low on net. They need a forecheck. It doesn't matter how many goals they give up right now, so they can afford to pinch and play up a little bit and try and counterattack. But what they can't do is afford to sit back and play a little more sound defense than what they're used to, because the defense need to start making plays up from the back end.
Mantha, shot towards the net. And it's a good stick there by the Tommies, but the Carabins keep it in. Alamo, cross-ice pass. What a pass. And it rings it off the bar there by Garipé. Deschen back in front, and a beautiful block by Brewster, who laid it out there to get in front of that one. But the Carabins still continue to hold the play. Deschen walks to the middle, shoots up high, and Wolf covers up.
I think Brewster may have taken a stinger on that one when she blocked the shot. I think it hit right off the side of her, and you can see her getting up slowly there. May have hit either on her right in the rib cage or on the side of the thigh. I'm not sure, but definitely slow to get up. St. Thomas have another 35 seconds to kill off this penalty, and that'll leave 6 minutes left in this hockey game for them to score 4 goals. Like I said before, they can't afford to just sit back anymore, as maybe it looks like... Kristen Wolf may have
got stung
taken
as well.
A stinger, yeah.
But the one thing you got to give credit to is the fans have not stopped cheering all game long, and they still get excited every time the Tommies come in the offensive end. taking the draw right now. It looks like it'll bounce. She wins it back, but the Tommies come away with the play. Bounced off the wall. Good play by Thompson there to try to create something, but instead it went all the way back to Boldia. Only 20 seconds remaining on the penalty to Gates. The Tommies' penalty kill has been pretty solid, but it's just the fact that they're down three and they can't even afford to be on the penalty kill.
Well, their penalty kill's been solid, but their power play has hurt them. 1-for-7 last night against Saskatchewan isn't how you win this tournament.
And that is swung all the way down the ice. This penalty is now over as Gates is going to re-enter the ice, and we are back to 5-on-5 with 6 minutes remaining in this game. The Carabins have yet to allow a goal in this tournament. Cross-ice pass. Coming in off is Francis. She'll just dump that down, chasing after it herself. Behind the net is Duval, who tries to bank it over, and it banks it off the back of the net. Scott tried to hold the line, but could not.
5:40 to go. They need something right now in this next minute.
Francis tries to get it in, but once again couldn't get across the blue line. Coming in is Legault. Tries to go around Steiner, but couldn't, and Steiner takes her down. Ryan has Francis with her. Ryan will just chip that down.
Emily Ryan, the big goal scorer, getting St. Thomas back into the game last night against Saskatchewan. Only played 9 games this year in the regular season, but Pete Murphy said once she gets back into the lineup, she can be dynamic. Hasn't been the case tonight as St. Thomas may be catching a break here with the linesman.
We've heard that a few times. Banked all the way down.
Somebody
the ice.
Got for icing, I think. No.
Wow, no. Waved off at the final second here, and going back for it is DeLorme. Swings it across, but Charlebois can't clear it. Snyder pinching in, swings it down. Anderson chasing after that. Nice play by Anderson to take it away from Robert. Or Lehoux, my mistake. And Brewster back to the point. Burns just fires it. It looked like it hit the outside of the net. And a great chance there as Burns just wound up for that. You're seeing a lot of people losing their footing so far in this match. Anderson tries to get it around, but the 6'3" Beaudry gets in front of it. Appleton swipes at it. Now Anderson has it. And I thought I heard a whistle. The play continues. Snyder comes in, gives it to Anderson. Anderson being bear hugged right now. Two of the Carabins players come in. Appleton takes a swipe. No one can find that puck right now. And that is whistled down with 4:08 remaining.
St. Thomas needs to win this faceoff right now, and then they need to get a goal because there's 4:08 left on that clock, and once you get inside that 4-minute mark, you start telling yourself as a player, oh my goodness, I need a goal. We need to average a goal a minute, which is very, very tough to do. Then you start getting down on yourself and losing hope. They need to win this faceoff and get a shot and score.
When do you pull Wolf?
Oh, 2:30. Maybe 3.
Agree. Tommies lose that draw, but they keep it in. It looks like McKaysey's going to keep it in. Swung all the way around. McDonald should be able to keep it in at the line. She calls off of Thompson, but gives it to her now. Thompson swings at it. Puck stays in. McDonald. Wolf still has not yet to leave her net. 3:50 remaining in this period, though.
And Wolf's not even looking to leave her net yet.
She's staying right in. 3:45 left in this period. Tommy's down 3-0. Coming back is Gary Pay.
And the linesman getting caught with the puck again.
It's a bad spot right there at the blue line. Taking away Deschen now. Scott will just swipe. Can't get it past half, though. Alamo takes out McIsaac. No call. Here comes Scott. 3:30 remaining. Gives it up to Ryan. Ryan will just push that down. But after it is Duval, the defender for the Carabins, who's played big minutes so far in this game. And she has the puck right now. We're just about to enter the 3-minute mark. Deschen chasing after that puck. She takes a swing at it, but Steinhardt gets to it first. McTaggart loses her stick, forced to go towards the bench. Scott can't clear it as she takes a dive at it. Legault now, all alone inside, passing it down. Nice tic-tac-toe as it tried to get in front, but couldn't. Here goes the Tommies. Brewster's one-on-one with 2:50 remaining. Brewster tries for the move, but I think she slipped on the puck.
I think she stepped on the puck. You're right, Rob. Now 2:40 to go in this game. I think it's all said and done for the St. Thomas Tommies, but if they can get a goal, they can do what no other team in this tournament has been able to do so far, and that is beat Elazie Rousseau-Sirois. So maybe a small victory for this Tommies, and they can get one late.
Apperson trying to get it out. Gives it to Snyder, the defense woman, picking up, and she takes a hard shot and just wide.
Eliza Snyder, possibly the hardest slap shot on this team, but she just missed it there, trying to pick the top corner.
Brewster still on the ice right now. That top line can't keep the puck in, though. 2:05 remaining. Shots 32-22 in favor of the Carabins. Apperson now winds up, but is blocked in front by Duval. Wolf not leaving her net. Maybe they won't pull her. Who knows what's going on right now with Murphy's decision at that. Down 3-0 with a muck 50 remaining. Tommies keep it in, though. Marceline swings it to Thompson, gets a shot off, and Sirois covers up high.
Good angling by Sirois down there, and a better shot by Mavonwe Thompson, but not. I don't think she quite got all of that shot as she could have. But she just put it in Sirois' chest, and Sirois sliding across made a great save.
In a minute 45, we'll hear from Nick Murray's three stars of the evening.
Yeah, I got to get those ready. But, I mean, again, for St. Thomas, I don't think that they'll pull Wolf, just because you look at the tournament standings. Saskatchewan lost to Montreal 3-0, and now St. Thomas will lose to Montreal 3-0. So maybe, you know what, that tells people that, hey, maybe we're at the same level as Saskatchewan could, because yesterday that game could have gone either way.
Good point. St. Thomas losing 3-2 against Saskatchewan in a hard-fought match. And Tommy's keeping their own here against the Carabins. And they score right when we say that. Richard with the spinorama.
And that's one Kristen Wolf wishes that she could have back on the Carabins side of the ice, because that just went 5-hole. And that's really, again, I don't want to say that that's necessarily a bad goal. That's just a good heads-up spinning shot down there from Catherine Richard. But the backbreaker from the St. Thomas Tommies, and unfortunately that might be all they said and done. Now, last night, Saskatchewan scored another goal late, and St. Thomas fought back. If St. Thomas can get one here, again, that would be a huge kind of, you know, a bit of a silver lining, if you will. I mean, it does suck in the terms that, or it's unfortunate in the terms that they didn't come out with the win that they expected, but nothing to hang their heads about. They had a good, hard effort tonight.
Brewster now back on that top line. We'll get one more chance at breaking the shutout of Sirois. And there's going to be a penalty.
And Baudry's going to go off for head contact. Brewster was battling with Baudry down there. And that's just a case of a 6'3" Baudry getting the upper edge on Brewster. She was just too tall and maybe knocked her in the noggin a little bit there. So now St. Thomas will get a power play chance with a minute and 10 left to go. They scored on the power play late last night against Saskatchewan to finish off 1-for-7, but unfortunately for St. Thomas, their power play in this tournament has been symbolic of how it's been all season, and that's ineffective.
Brewster wins the draw. Cross ice, takes a shot towards net. Anderson tried to tip that one, and that will get out of the zone with a minute remaining in this game. It looks like it's going to be an all-Montreal final coming up here with Montreal Carabins up 4-0 against the Tommies. Of course, McGill winning earlier. Steiner, cross ice. Snyder tries the shot, and the Carabins can't clear it. Steiner with a broken stick, and she plays it.
No penalty, though.
Yeah, that's a very interesting play there.
And the Carabins won't bark at that one, but you're absolutely right. Eliza Snyder down there played the puck with a broken stick and didn't get a penalty for it. I mean, luckily.
And she got a shot off. That was very interesting.
Yeah.
36.3 seconds like, remaining.
I mean, it wasn't as if, like, that penalty can be called if she even makes an attempt to play the puck. But right there, she touched it and almost tried to play it like a ringette. And I think Murphy is going to call a timeout right now. And again, they want to try and get one goal, so maybe a silver lining for Pete Murphy if he can get a goal here.
Also like to mention that the Tommies now, that's going to be a tough turnaround time tomorrow, Nick. Playing tonight, and game's going to only end around 9:30.
And they got to come back and play at 10:30. You're absolutely right. So we have an all-AUS matchup for the fifth place game and an all-RESQ matchup for the gold medal game. Now that'll be definitely one to watch, because McGill are hungry to get back into the series, or get back at Montreal for losing that. And McGill came into this tournament as the fifth seed, as the wild card. And we've said time and time again that they are most certainly not a fifth seed hockey team for this tournament.
Of course. And as Nick just mentioned, the Tommies, they're going to have they're still in the power play for a minute 26, but there's only 36 seconds remaining in the game. Murphy calling a timeout, drawing up a play. And he's pulling Wolf right now, so it's going to be a 6-on-4 for the last 36 seconds.
No, I don't blame him here, because if you keep the score 3-0, then you'd match up the same as Saskatchewan. But right now, they've already eclipsed that margin. So if you can get a goal here again, you can do something the Saskatchewan wasn't able to do.
And Brewster comes off the draw, cuts towards the center. It's a shot and a great save by Seattle with the glove.
I think that just hit a body in front and tipped away.
Brewster now working with Anderson. No one can find the puck, but Alamo does, and that's a great play by her to get that out to center. 15 seconds in this game. Tommy's maybe one last rush. And the Montreal Carabins with 10 seconds left are playing great defensive hockey right now. Baudry, the woman in the penalty box, is cheering her team on. And that will do it. The Carabins are off to the final to try to defend their championship.
A great, great game by the Montreal Carabins. Not the same type of hockey as we saw against the Saskatchewan Huskies. Actually, you know what? Head coach Isabelle Leclerc said that after that Saskatchewan game, she wasn't happy with the way that her team played. And I don't think that she's going to think very highly of her team tonight, because Montreal, and from what I've seen, didn't play as good of a game as they did against Saskatchewan. But you know what? Full credit to the St. Thomas Tommies for being a gritty, gritty hockey team and coming out early, coming out strong, forcing turnovers in the offensive zone. But unfortunately, you know what the backbreaker was? There's two things right here. One, unfortunately, I hate to knock Kristen Wolf because she played absolutely phenomenal, stopping 30 shots. But in that second period, diving out for that poke check and missing it was the backbreaker, I think, for the St. Thomas Tommies, because then a two goal, when you're down 1-0, you can score two goals, and you know, it's a mental thing, you know, when you're down 3-0, and I mean, unless you're the Boston Bruins against the Toronto Maple Leafs, it's a very surmountable lead, or it's a very insurmountable lead for most times, because again, it's that mental game, and especially when you're down by three goals and you still have to score one more, then it kind of gets difficult. But again, I think the backbreaker for St. Thomas again was Wolf missing that that play there. But now you see St. Thomas actually saluting their fans as they go off the ice.
I also like Tommy the Tomcat shaking every one of the Carabins' hands.
Absolutely, as he goes. You're absolutely right, Rob. That's a good point down there. Looking at the three stars, I think my third star of the game absolutely is Elodie Rousseau-Sirois, stopping all 23 shots St. Thomas sent her away for her second shutout of this tournament. And the first star, despite the mistake, I think Kristen Wolf kept St. Thomas in the game. She should be the player of the game for the Tommies.
Yep.
In that, again, the big mistake, I think, was the backbreaker when she went for that poke check. But I think player of the game for Montreal, I think Ariane Barker.